Welcome to the 2017 Florida Classic presented by McDonald's. Camping World Stadium, downtown Orlando, the setting, as today a Sunshine State rivalry dating back nearly a century continues. Since 1978, close to 2 million fans have attended this great event, making the Florida Classic the biggest black college football game in the country. The Rattlers of Florida A&M are set to battle the Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman. And a pleasant good afternoon, everybody. Sean Kinney alongside former Florida State national champion Forrest Conley. Great to have you with us. This week is way more than just a football game. This is a weekend to celebrate the heritage, the legacy, and quite frankly, the pageantry of these two rich HBCUs.
Well, you throw the records out the door. If you're from the state of Florida, you know about the Florida Classic. This is a big-time ball game for bragging rights, for recruiting purposes. This is it for both of these ball clubs. They have no postseason. This is the last game of the season, and I expect to see a great ball game.
These two football teams have had success this season. Both are led by quarterbacks. One entering the sophomore year, one getting set to take his final snap of his career. Larry Brim and Ryan Stanley, both very similar in what they can do on the field.
Well, the thing that Ryan Stanley does a good job of is the hard count. He tries to get the defense to jump off sides. He wants to get really good pre-snap reads. And for Larry Brim, he understands and he is a quarterback that knows what he wants to do with the football. He has escapability. I like his ability to get outside of the pocket, move around, allow his receivers to get open and find them down the field.
Alex Wood in his third year guiding the Rattler program as he gets set to try to figure out a way to beat Bethune-Cookman. He has not done it. In fact, the Rattlers haven't done it the last 6 years as he tries to put to the frustrations of this past season behind him. On the other side, the always emotional Terry Sims. He's geared up, ready to go, and why not? After last week's thrilling finish, as his guys pulled off a miraculous finish in Durham, North Carolina, knocking off North Carolina Central.
Four down linemen, they rush four on a twist. Brim steps out to the left, steps up, scrambles to the left, tosses it towards the left side of the end zone. Tipped ball, still in the air, and it's caught by BCU. The Wildcats catch it. BCU wins on a Hail Mary, a tipped pass. My God!
That's what college football is all about. The 48-yard Hail Mary to Kevon Mitchell to beat North Carolina Central, a critical win, and now with some momentum heading into this final college football weekend for these two teams. We are underway from Orlando, and it will be Bethune-Cookman to get the football first, and on the return out past the 25 up to the 28-yard line. Penalty flag is down as the Wildcat offense will be on the field first. The return by Quayshawn Bird. Turn of 12 yards, but let's wait and see what the penalty is all about.
Illegal block.
Bethune-Cookman offense averaging close to 20 points per game, a very balanced attack, both rushing and throwing the football, and they are led by an experienced quarterback, Larry Brim, but this is a program that will utilize two quarterbacks. We'll see a lot of Akevious Williams, the redshirt sophomore, who is the future of the program, but right now it's Larry Brim's show, and you see the numbers he's put up, the high completion percentage, close to 2,000 yards, the 15 touchdowns. Very good decision maker, just the four picks.
Really good decision making, and I think with Williams, you get a RPO that you don't get from Brim. Brim can move around in the pocket, but Williams is more of a runner with the football.
Oh, Brim's on the very first play, is sacked back inside the five, a loss of nine as Florida at A&M was able to dial it up with Antonio Miller.
Well, what Miller did coming from the right defensive end spot is he got down past the offensive tackle. The tackles have to do a better job of kicking straight back. You cannot open up the door. You see number 72 open up the door, David Bryant. You've got to keep your shoulders square to the line of scrimmage. When you get to three steps, that's when you can turn, open those shoulders, and run him past the quarterback's level.
Fourth sack of the year by Miller. Second down and 19. The ball inside the one. Dangerous territory, and the Rattlers get the safety. A plethora of flags come out, but again, the penetration by Emilio Gibbs.
And unfortunately, I think they're going to get a face mask on this. It looked like Gibbs grabbed the face mask of the running back. He didn't have to do that. Pursuit got there. And that is what you call, Sean, a game-altering penalty. Because you've got 2 points that you just took off the board. You got possession of the football that you just lost. A great play to get back there to make the play by Gibbs, but you got to make the tackle correctly.
Look at this season of missed opportunities for Florida A&M. They've had a number of games in which they've led throughout the course of the three quarters, only to slip up in the end. Mistakes like that, a big reason why they've won only three games this year. Absolute killer. It takes 2 points off the board plus a fresh set of downs as they run the shovel pass and pursuit defense by Terry Jefferson.
And a good job by the left defensive end, Elijah Price, to hold at the point of attack. And you're talking about impact players. Right now, you've got Terry Jefferson. He leads the team in interceptions, but will play in the box. And Frank Brown, he's a possession-type receiver with big play potential. Also a special teams threat.
Second down and 11. The ball marked at the 15-yard line. The Rattlers show blitz, and Bethune-Cookman flinched. This is an emotional game for us, and you go back to your rivalry days with Florida State. The engine gets cranked up a couple of notches for these types of games.
Well, you don't think about records in these ball games. It's about pride. You're looking at recruiting. These are guys that played together in high school, went on the recruiting trips together, played in Little League. They grew up together. So it's a neighborhood battle, so to speak.
Four early penalties, and we're not even 3 minutes into this first quarter. Second down and 16, the ball at the 10-yard line. Four receivers set. Brim with a nice pocket, settles over the middle in the crossing pattern. Nice stop-and-go move out past the 15-yard line. Back to the original line of scrimmage for Keyvon Mitchell.
And you see the stop-and-go ability by Mitchell. The linebacker had a bead on Mitchell, but he's so fast and so quick. Josh Crutchfield could not get to him. That's what you want to see from your receivers in the open field. Make plays when you get possession of the football. That'll be key this afternoon. Getting the ball to your playmakers in open field and seeing what they can do.
Mitchell, Brown, Davis, all with at least 30 catches this season. Third down and 11. Brim steps up. Pocket collapsing around. He'll take off and run and pick up the first down. Here comes a flag as Brim scoots for first down yardage, but a flag thrown in the vicinity of a hole. So a defensive holding call on the secondary, and Bethune-Cookman able to convert on third down.
And that was a result of Brim's escapability. You saw the defensive back look back. He saw Brim running towards the line of scrimmage as he got outside the pocket, and he lost the receiver, so he grabbed him to try and get back to him.
For a set of downs and movement all over the place, and here comes another flag. Obviously, as you can hear, some microphone issues with our official, but flags have plagued these two teams at different junctures throughout the course of the year. And look at Bethune-Cookman. They had a game in which they committed 19 penalties earlier this year against South Carolina State. It has been an area of concern for Terry Sims and the Wildcats. First and 15 from the 22. They dump it out to the flats for a minimal gain. This is a very aggressive Florida A&M defense. They will pursue the football, especially when Michael Jones touches it, because he's a playmaker.
Well, that's what you have to do. You have to get pursuit, but you also want to force the ball back towards the pursuit, back towards the center of the field. You don't want to give up the sideline.
They're happy to have Jones back. He missed all of last season with a hamstring injury. He's been banged up this year as well. Jones and Jamaris Tompkins, the two main ball carriers this season for Bethune-Cookman. Second down and 15.
Brim looking downfield, still trying to buy some time, settles over the middle, and it's caught at the 35-yard line, driving toward the first down marker. And look at the will here by Mitchell. First down for the Wildcats. A rivalry game. You crank up that engine like we talked about, and the 173-pounder looking like a 200-pounder here at the end of the catch.
Well, a good job by Brim. You see him get outside the pocket. He's running. He gets pressure. He feels pressure. He climbs the pocket. He's still looking upfield. And Mitchell did a good job of sitting down in that zone and making himself big for Brim to get to.
18 yards in the completion, and here's offsides for the Rattlers.
5-yard penalty, first down.
And so far, we've had some sloppy play, and you have to wonder if that's nerves, because both teams know that this is a big ball game.
A couple of catches on this drive for Mitchell. Brim has started 4 for 4. We talked about the high completion percentage for both these quarterbacks at the start. Both smart with the football. First down and 5 from the 45, and it's the quick hitter straight up the middle. 2, maybe 3 hard-fought yards. Demontre Moore, the junior from Tampa, Florida, one of a handful of community college transfers onto the Rattler side of the defense. Shifting on that defensive line. They'll rotate 4 or 5 guys off the bench that they feel comfortable with. Zone read, RPO option, and Brim sails it high, incomplete. Probably a good thing he did. The Rattler corner was in the pickings for a possible interception.
And you saw Orlando McKinley waiting for Brim to let go of that football. I think Brim saw him at the last minute and put a lot on it to just get it out of bounds. He wanted to go to Mitchell, his big play receiver, but you have to be careful because you know that Florida A&M is watching Mitchell. They're probably going to bracket him at times, have coverage underneath and on top.
Another third down situation for the Wildcats, third and short. Brim will keep it, go into a protective slide and move the chains for a first down. Heady play by Larry Brim, and Bethune-Cookman pushes on to the FAMU side after the 2-yard run. Look at this offense led by Brim this year, the fifth-year senior from Delray Beach, Florida, Village Academy, and they have put up some good numbers during this current win streak. Blitz off the edge is picked up, and again, Brim just taking what the defense is giving it. 12 more yards and a first down.
And Brim did a good job of looking off the linebackers on that play. He looked down the field like he wanted to go deep, and he found his receiver in the middle of the field. That's what you have to do. That's what you see from seasoned quarterbacks, going through their progressions and knowing where their receivers will be.
38-yard line, Brim looking right. Third catch of the drive by Mitchell, and he is tackled immediately. Tyler Woodley, the sophomore from Atlanta, with a good open field stop. Talk about this winning streak for Bethune-Cookman, trying to build some momentum. Very similar to what they did last year. If you recall, they had that tough September, October. They won 5 of their final 6 to close out last year, trying to do the same here in 2017. Big win of that trio. Last week's Hail Mary thriller against North Carolina Central really delivering a blow for NC Central's hopes of capturing a MEAC title. Play clock at 5 as Brim takes the snap, dodges Gibbs, scrapes ahead, maybe a half a yard. Penetration initially by Emilio Gibbs. Setting up another third down for the Wildcats.
And that was a good job by Gibbs. He got penetration, but he stayed put. He did not commit. He made Brim make a decision. That's what you want to do. You want to make the quarterback make the decision.
Talked about how they like to use two quarterbacks. We'll get our first look at Akevious Williams. Redshirt sophomore has been an active component in this offense. He's thrown for 100 yards, a couple of touchdowns, 2 interceptions. And with the change at quarterback, Bethune-Cookman is going to have to burn a timeout. They did not have the right personnel on the field. It's always a tricky matter when you rotate two quarterbacks, and Terry Sims believes in that, especially when you have two talented quarterbacks with not a lot of separation in what they can do on the field.
Well, you got to be ready. You got to be prepared. And when you bring in different personnel, they have to be ready to go. That's why offensive coaches always want the entire offense lined up behind them, ready to go at the sideline as opposed to just walking around. You've got to be prepared. You don't want to use timeouts when you don't have to. And this is a situation where you shouldn't have used a timeout because you knew you were coming in with Williams at quarterback.
So Brim sits, Williams is in. Bethune-Cookman has dominated this series of late. 72nd meeting, dating all the way back to 1925. Last year, Bethune-Cookman won in a blowout. They've won six in a row. It's only happened. So after the timeout, illegal substitution, I believe, the call on Bethune-Cookman.
And this is totally uncalled for. First, you have to call a timeout. Now you have 12 players on the field. You go from third and what, three to now third and eight or third and nine. You can't do this. These are the type of intangibles that you cannot have. You have got to be smart. You cannot allow this to happen. And I'm sure that Coach Sims is disappointed right now in his team.
See if Williams puts the ball up. 12th play of this opening drive for the Wildcats. Pressure off the edge. Williams steps up, fires toward the flats, passes caught, but blowing a tire and going down immediately. Shy of the first down at the 31-yard line is Jawill Davis. It's a pickup of six and a decision early on for Terry Sims in this offense.
And I think they definitely have to go for it. There's no question. They're not even thinking about it. They know what they want to do. And when you've got Williams in the game with his escapability and his ability to get outside the pocket and run, because he is really a true RPO type of quarterback, I think it's the best play for him.
Fourth down and three. Williams a pump. Nobody open. He'll try to run ahead, and the Rattlers say, nuh-uh, not happening. FAMU and their defense comes up with the stop. Bethune-Cookman gives it up on downs on the 14th play of the drive. It's that pressure. They get to Williams. Wildcats come up empty.
The 2017 Florida Classic is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it.
This truly is a three-day celebration in Orlando. The Pride and the Battle of the Bands. Bethune-Cookman and the Pride getting loose, getting ready for their halftime show, matched up against the Marching 100. It's going to be a treat coming up at halftime with the Battle of the Bands. Series number one for Ryan Stanley and the Rattler offense. Finally touched the football after a long drive, came up empty for Bethune-Cookman. Stanley making his 11th start of the season, 15 touchdown passes. That's second in the MEAC, also second in that high completion percentage. Under pressure, back foot throw, downfield, jump ball, and it's hauled in. Oh my, what a catch along the near side by Kareem Smith. And they're going to say he came out of bounds. Came down with it. Terrific effort on the 50-50 ball.
And I tell you what, even Coach Sims had to pat him on the head because that was a great catch by Smith. I think he was in bounds. I'm interested to see if they go back and look at this play because he's in bounds. You've got a foot down right there. The question is, did he control the football as he came down? You see right here, here's another angle right here. He's got control of the football. The ball doesn't move. I think they're going to reverse this call, and this will be a reception by Smith. And once again, you know it's a great catch when the opposing head coach pats you on the helmet to say, hey, that was a great play.
Mutual respect. Don't get me wrong. It's an intense rivalry with these two schools, but a lot of respect representing the Sunshine State, the all-MEAC performer. I think we both agree is going to have a catch here as they take a look upstairs.
And this is what you want from your receiver. You've got to go up and you've got to fight for footballs. Every throw is not going to be perfect. Right here, he has to grab the ball and pull it away from the defender, Kennedy Ndukwe, because Ndukwe had a bead on that football. He got his right hand up, but he could not pull it down. And you saw Kareem Smith able to squeeze the football. He high points the football right here. And then he brings it to his body. He maintains control. And I am sure this is going to be a reverse call and be a catch and a first down for Florida A&M. And a great play to start this offensive drive for them.
Clearly, the evidence you feel is there. Call on the field was no catch. You say enough evidence to overturn it and give Smith the catch.
Well, I think it is. The one thing you look for, you saw the left foot and the right foot get down, but you saw the ball. Once he catches the football, when he gets to the ground, what the officials are looking for to see if the ball moves any. As long as he maintains possession of the football and it doesn't move, that is considered a catch. And that's what I saw him hold on to the football. I think that's what they're looking for. I think they've determined that he is in bounds. They want to make sure he completed the catch, which means the ball did not move once he hit the ground.
It's been an eventful first quarter with six penalties, and now as we take another look, did Smith control it? Clearly the foot inbounds, and as Forrest mentioned, the question becomes control as he comes down to the turf here at Camping World Stadium. Jockeying for the football with Ndukwe.
And the defender did everything that he could on that play. Those are the type of balls as a quarterback, you put it out there and you tell your receiver, hey, make a play for me. Because it was not a perfect throw. Ryan Stanley was under pressure. He threw it off of his back foot. But Smith went up and made a play for him.
Smith is part of a veteran receiving corps for Coach Alex Wood. All-MEAC performer. He is the leader of the corps this year. They had a vocal leader graduate a season ago in Mo Williams. And see if this was a catch you need. Well, if he can read lips, the call on the field changes, and my partner Forrest, you're still perfect this year on those overturns.
Well, that was a pretty easy one. And I think when you look at it in regular speed, I understand why the official called it out of bounds. But once again, a great play and a great start for Florida A&M's offense.
It's a gain of 15 yards and a first down. And here comes Stanley and the Rattlers. They bunch up three to the top of the field. Out of the pistol set, no tight ends for Florida A&M. On the zone read, Enrilis bust through a hole. And this guy has been on a tear the last couple of weeks.
Well, the one thing I like about him is he does not go down with on tackles. 153 yards on 20 carries the last time this ball club played. And he's had 2 weeks to get fresh legs. So Bethune-Cookman has to be prepared for him running in between the tackles. He runs behind his pads, and he does a good job of breaking arm tackles.
2 weeks ago, he rushed for a career high, 153 yards against Howard. Slowed down early in the season by an ankle injury, but he is healthy at the stretch, and redshirt freshman putting up big numbers from that backfield spot. He'll get the call again, lunging ahead over the right side, falls inside the 40, a gain of two.
And watch Ryan Stanley throughout this ball game. He's going to walk up to the line of scrimmage. He's going to survey the defense. He's going to get his pre-snap reads. Then he's going to make his call. One thing that Bethune-Cookman has to do a good job of is fooling him. You want to play games. You want to show him something in his early pre-snap read and shift around. You want to play mind games. You cannot allow Stanley to know what you're doing.
From the 39-yard line, double move downfield. He was looking for Murphy, and he was decked. Safety help by Richardson coming over the top.
And I think Murphy saw Richardson and decided he's going to get alligator arms. Murphy had an opportunity to make a play, and you got to get out there, you got to dive, you got to leave it out there on the field. I understand why you get alligator arms when you see a free safety flying across the field, but you got to make those catches. Ryan Stanley put the ball where Murphy could have made a play on it.
Daquan Richardson, leader of the secondary. Senior out of Alvin, South Carolina. He's the main guy that creates turnovers. Third down and eight. Stanley with all sorts of time. Sets it over the middle through the hands of the receiver. Incomplete. Elliott Miller with the tight coverage.
And receivers, you've got to help your quarterback out. You've got to squeeze that football. A good job by Stanley. He had a lot of time in the pocket. The offensive line is doing a good job giving him time to get the ball down the field. You see, he's got a pocket. He can survey the field. And this is a catch. It was a little bit behind, but the receiver has to make that catch. Brandon Norwood, you know, one of their better receivers, he has to make that catch.
Yeah, he's their top receiving target this year. 45 catches for Norwood, who was a first-team All-MEAC performer last year. Frank Brown awaiting the punt inside the 10. High spiraling kick, and it sails into the end zone despite the efforts of the cover unit. So each team has had it once. Nothing settled. It's the Florida Classic from Orlando.
As a licensed...
They've been playing this one for about as long as we've been playing the Florida Classic, since 1929. Tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC, number 11 USC hosts UCLA at the Coliseum. Josh Rosen versus Sam Darnold. Victory Bell once again on the line, with the Trojans winning the last two meetings and looking to keep their college football playoff hopes alive. Also streaming live on the ESPN app. Series number two for Bethune-Cookman, as Larry Brim engineered, for the most part, a 14-play drive that saw a Wildcat stall deep in Rattler territory. They start from the 20. And on first down, a quick hitter up the middle, and that's 9 yards up to the 29-yard line. Over that right side, Dwayne Brown and Phillip Norman, two good run blockers on that offensive front wall.
And I think this is the best way to attack this Florida A&M defense, right down the gut of it. I think Florida A&M has an advantage on the outside with their speed rushers, with Price and with Akbar, Miller, and Crutchfield. You have to attack the middle of this defense. If you allow Gibbs to make plays without the ball coming towards him, he can be disruptive. If you go right at him, now you eliminate his ability to be a big play threat.
On second down, Tompkins gets his second straight call. Jamaris Tompkins, a fifth-year senior from Tampa, Florida, 13 MEAC selection a year ago, and he's really developed into the guy this season. Michael Jones was banged up early. We'll see some Tupac Istey a little bit later on in the course of the game, but this is the guy that they want to be the workhorse of the offense.
Well, Tompkins is a hard hat type of runner. He's one of those guys that doesn't mind running in those A gaps in between both guards. He can hit it downhill, and he has power. He's a power runner at 210 pounds.
Rim with time, whistles it toward the sideline, pass is caught. Davis hangs on to this one, a pickup of 11 and a first down.
And right now, they seem to be throwing at Orlando McKinley a lot. I've noticed number 10 in coverage with a lot of these throws going towards his way.
Up-tempo style, they whip it out to Mitchell, who slips free, cuts back toward the center of the field. Tough running, that's twice now, yards after contact from the elusive Kevon Mitchell.
And that's where he's dynamic, when he gets the ball in the open field and he's one-on-one with the defender. You see him catch the football right here, and it looks like he's going to be out of bounds, but he stays in bounds. He shakes off a tackler and gets back to the middle of the field and gets 5 extra yards.
Second down and short, the quick passing game on target. Mitchell again, first down, as he sidesteps to the 42.
And that was a great job by Jawil Davis, number 17, blocking on the perimeter. That's what helps. When you get a receiver, a reception outside, the key to getting up the field and vertical is your perimeter blocking. A good job by Davis to get a block out on the perimeter to spring him to get that first down.
5 catches for 44 yards for Mitchell in this first quarter. Second straight series, Bethune-Cookman has driven it onto the Rattler side, but they're going the wrong way this time. In the backfield, a loss. Antonio Miller again, a loss of 5.
And on this play, I think it was a broken play. Number 72, the left tackle, David Bryant. he went inside. He did not block on the outside, and there was a free release for the defensive end. You see, nobody blocked him. You had an H-back back there. Nobody blocked the defensive end. You always have to block the MDM, the most dangerous man, the closest man to the ball carrier. You allow the ball carrier to make a play against the guy that's further away. You've got to block the closest man. You cannot give him a free release because no one is there. By the time the ball carrier got possession of the football, he was on top of it.
Second down and 15. They go back to the security of the quick passing game, and this is Stephon Francois. Francois up near the 40-yard line. Gain of 10, setting up a manageable third down and 6. And they're in the portion of the field for us where they're probably thinking four down territory again.
Well, also, I want to see if Florida A&M's defensive coaches want to start to jump some of these short routes, because there's no pump faking. Larry Brim is IDing his receiver very quickly off the snap. Let's see if they jump some of these short routes.
Woodley bluffed as if he was going to come on a cornerback blitz, and now they bring it from the strong side, and an easy call here, and that's just lack of discipline coming in carelessly from his linebacker position with Jacaris Wilson, who's had a fine season, one of the top tacklers. But boy, Forrest, there has to come a time where you have to have some discipline.
Well, once again, you've got Brim, a seasoned quarterback, and he sees and recognizes the blitz, so he probably held that snap count a little bit.
Third down and short, another flag thrown, wide open down the center of the field, making the catch, lunging ahead for the touchdown. The ball popped free late, but it's going to stick as Jaquan Loomis hauls it in. Now let's wait and see what the penalty's all about. Offside
against the Rattlers.
A&M touchdown, 35 yards.
And this was a misdirection play, but Bethune couldn't have done on this play. They pulled the right tackle, Philip Norman, around. So what that did was that froze the linebackers. When you see a tackle pulling, you assume that it's going to be a running play. And that slight freeze by the linebackers allowed the receiver to get behind them and get the easy score.
I'd be surprised if they take another look to see if Loomis first got the football across the goal line and secondly had control of the football before it popped free, and that the ground did not cause it to come rolling out of there. So they're going to take a look upstairs.
And it was one of those boom, boom plays, but it started with the right tackle pulling around. Now he's got possession of the football. It'll be interesting. Where's that left elbow down?
Check, check. Check, check, check. 1, 2, 3, 4. Check, check.
Was the left elbow down? Let's see right here. We've got a better view. Left elbow's up. Left elbow's up. I think from that view, they've got to call it a touchdown. There's nothing clear to overturn that call. But it all started with the misdirection, pulling the right tackle. They were very close to that being an illegal player downfield because they threw the football. Because Philip Norman kept going right up through the hole and almost got to linebacker level. But it was a good job selling, and that's what you want to do. You want to sell to those linebackers that it's a running play. Once again, I don't know if it's enough from this view to overturn this call. It was called a touchdown on the field, and it has to be indisputable to overturn it.
If the call sticks, an 8-play, 80-yard drive by Bethune-Cookman. And for Loomis.
Well, from that angle, you see the hand down. You don't see the elbow down, so I think it's going to be a touchdown.
I agree.
But I thought it was a great play call. I think what the coaching staff will do, though, is tell the offensive lineman, if you're going to pull around on those plays, make sure you stay within 2 yards of the line of scrimmage so you don't get called from any illegal player down the field. But a great play call by the Bethune coaching staff.
Terry Sims has to be happy with this start. His offense has been on the field virtually the entire first quarter. They have amassed 129 yards of offense if this call stands, and let's see.
Touchdown!
And it is a touchdown, as we both thought. Loomis, the tight end, with his second touchdown reception of the year.
And watch number 71. You see him pull around. Now you see the linebackers freeze. Now 71 is almost right here. He's almost too far down the field. He has to be careful and stay within this range right here. But a good job and a great play call because it froze the linebackers and allowed the receiver, the tight end, to get behind them and get to the end zone.
Point after by Uriel Hernandez is good. So it's Bethune-Cookman who fires the opening salvo. The Wildcats draw first blood here in Orlando. Leaders of this offense, Jaquan Loomis, very versatile player, arrived at Bethune-Cookman as a wide receiver, made the move to tight end 2 years ago, had just two career catches coming in to this season, but he has exploded. 14 receptions, his second touchdown of the year, and a young man who's going to be moving to China in December to teach the English language as he moves on to the next step of his career. But Bethune-Cookman clearly dominating in all phases here in this first quarter. It's been an offense that has eaten up the clock, and a Wildcat offense that was able to produce six late. Touchdown the Loomis. Bethune-Cookman leading the Florida Classic after one. The ESPN app is a fan's best friend. Stream every ESPN and ABC college football game live at home or on the go. You'll also get access to scores, news, and highlights all season long. Download the ESPN app to start streaming now. For us from your days in Tallahassee, you know this weekend is all about the fans. This is the date they circle at the beginning of the year, 40,000 strong gathering here in Orlando for this three-day festival.
Absolutely. It's not just a ball game. It's an event. And you see the fans outside the stadium, around everywhere. This is what everybody waits for at the end of the season. You talk about all the other classics. This, to me, and I know I'm partial because I'm from Florida. I went to school in Tallahassee, where Florida A&M is located. But I think this is the biggest and best classic of all the HBCUs.
What makes this so special?
Offense number 70. 15-yard penalty. Replay first down.
Well, when you talk about athletes, you talk about elite athletes, I think the state of Florida leads the way, leads the pack. So you've got kids on these HBCU ball clubs that can play at FBS programs, FCS programs, at some of the larger FCS programs. I think you see supreme athletes come out of this conference to MEAC, and I think this is just one of those games where you see all the fans here. You see the bragging rights. They've almost got Camping World Stadium filled up, and it's a great day for football, and it's a great venue.
See if this offense can get something started, and they won't get the trend going their direction on that play. Gang tackling by Bethune-Cookman. Jerome Howard, the plugger in the middle, the true freshman from Sarasota.
I think for Florida A&M, they need to try and get vertical. You've got to go down the field. You've got to make Bethune-Cookman respect your ability to pass the ball down the field.
Penalty and the loss of two. The Rattlers moving the wrong way. Second and long. Stanley looking right, sets it. This time Norwood hangs on. A big gainer out here, the 35. Tripped up at the 39-yard line. 27 yards in the completion and a first down.
And that's a great job by Stanley. He's held tight in the pocket. You see him? He's got a pocket. He's able to survey the field. And he hits Norwood in stride, and you see the speed. Norwood was a shoestring away from breaking that up the field. Right, and he beats the defensive back to the inside, Elliot Miller, and you see him get up the field. Miller did a good job of tackling him, getting his feet, because Norwood looked like he was getting ready to shift into second gear as he got north and south on that play.
It's a big play. I know it's early in this game, but it's a field position changer and maybe allows the Rattlers to get some traction. Again, over the middle, wide open, Kareem Smith, first down, 45. Smith falls ahead to the 41-yard line, tackled by Miller.
And what Stanley is doing, he's going where they're bringing the pressure from. A good job by Stanley recognizing where the pressure is coming from. And when the pressure comes, he finds his receiver that is right in that area.
26 and now 20 yards through the air in the last two completions. They'll try to get that ground game started, but to no luck. Devin James, the true freshman linebacker, leading the ball carry.
And when you get those completions like Stanley got, now you make your defensive backs stay back. They don't come up as close to the line of scrimmage, and that's when you try and break a run. That's why they got the run going. You may not get as many positive yards as you want, but you have to keep the defense honest. So you want to stick some run plays in there.
Don't use a lot of two-back sets. Rattlers look confused, and they hardly go under center, but that's the case here with Stanley. Bowers and Spells are the two backs. Play fake by Stanley. He's going to hit Spells out of the backfield. Room to run. First down yardage. Breaks free, but he stepped out of bounds, they say. Back at the 31-yard line, Tevin Spells with just his third reception of the year.
And defenses aren't used to seeing two backs, and you see Spells able to sneak out of the backfield. I think the linebackers for Bethune-Cookman were a little bit confused because they had not seen that type of personnel by Florida A&M. A good job by Stanley delivering the football and allowing Spells to get up the field.
Good-looking counter drive by the Rattlers. They have it first and 10 at the Bethune-Cookman 31. Hand off left side, and Hinrala stays on his feet, bounces wide. Hinrala tight roping the sideline, pushed out at the 17. Oh, what balance by the redshirt freshman from Miami, 14 yards.
And on that play, the left tackle for Florida A&M, Rashad Williams, tried to throw the defensive end. He was able to get a hand on Hinrala, but we talked about it earlier, Hinrala's ability to break tackles. Watch, number 55 right here, he has an opportunity to make a play right there in the backfield, but Hinrala breaks off. You see his ability, the balance, and you see him able to get to the outside.
Inside the red zone for the first time today, the Rattlers. Pretty good red zone team this year. They have to hustle. Play clock to 2, down to 1, and FAMU is going to have to use a timeout.
Timeout. Florida A&M. It's the first timeout of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
I don't mind that timeout. Critical juncture. You're finally inside that red zone. A chance to keep up with this Bethune-Cookman offense.
Well, you can't take them to the locker room with you at halftime, so you might as well use it. You still have 2 more, and this is a critical drive. I think this drive gets them back in the ball game. We saw them offensively in the first quarter not have possession of the football a lot. Bethune-Cookman has controlled the possession. So for Florida A&M, not only do you get the right play in offensively, you also continue to allow your defense to get their legs back, to get back out here and hopefully get a stop when they get back on defense. So you've got to get the right play. This is a critical down for them. You're getting to, you know, you're inside the red zone, so the field gets smaller. So you have to be precise with where you want to go with the football.
Stanley 4-6 for 71 yards in this first half. After the timeout, here comes the blitz. They set up the screen. Low throw is dug out by Norwood. He spins to the short side and nowhere to go. Elliot Miller with the coverage.
And it's almost like the coaching staff for Bethune-Cookman said, okay, enough of this. Enough of Ryan standing back here and having all the time in the world. We're going to bring the house. That's what you have to do. You want to make him get rid of the football prematurely. Don't allow him to step into those throws. He had to throw that off of his back foot under duress. That's the kind of pressure you want to put on the quarterback.
Second down and 10. They go to the wildcat look and torpedoing ahead inside the 15, face first, diving forward goes Devin Bowers. A little bit of a twist with the wildcat and Bowers. Stanley will step back on the field for this passing situation. James, another stop.
And you know what's so interesting to me is when they run the wildcat formation, 95% of the time it's going to be a dive play in the A gaps, but no one has been able to stop it on a consistent basis.
Third down and 6. Let's see if Bethune-Cookman dials up another blitz. That's Smith in motion. They rush only 4, drop 7 in the coverage. Fake pattern back to the end zone. And a little bit too tall, incomplete. He was looking for Smith.
And a defender, number 22, Daquan Richardson, got away with the hold on that play. The officials let him play through it. There was a lot of touching and grabbing on that play.
Yahia Ali, a junior from Osceola, Iowa, has made his last 4 attempts, covering 37, 36, 24, and 42 yards. This one from 30 yards. Good snap. Line drive kick is up, and it's perfect. And the Rattlers get three. Ali with the field goal. Florida A&M is on the board. An impressive counterpunch. 7-3 early on, second quarter. Let's take a look at today's Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. And of course, it's all about the food. There's flavor all around the stadium for this Florida Classic.
Absolutely. Look at this. You got to have your game face on, ready to eat, because they are getting down all around the stadium.
Now, I love my food and I love big bites, but that is a big bite right there. Some of the delicacies in the Sunshine State.
Well, I'll tell you what, when I pulled up to the stadium, I ran into inside because I know if I got so many whiffs of good food out there, I wanted to go to somebody's tent and say, hey, just let me eat with you. Let me hang out for a little while.
Forrest and I don't have the best willpower when it comes to food selection. So, yeah, we had to make a beeline right to the booth. And speaking of making a beeline, Kevon Mitchell nearly made a beeline to the end zone that time as he was tripped up. It's a return of 31 yards. And you take a look at the rich history of this Florida Classic. Started back in 1978, the Rattlers and the Wildcats, their series all the way back to 1925. It's developed into the largest game between two HBCUs in the country. Close to 2 million people since the inception in 78. It has bounced around some venues, but it has found a home here in Orlando, marking the 20th year that it's been held here in O-Town. And the festivities included the weekend kickoff Thursday night, the comedy show, the Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime, and so much more jam-packed in the 72 hours of fun. Brim on first down. Nice patience down the sideline. Good yardage. Stepping out of bounds at the 48. A late shove, and this will net 15 more yards as they hit Michael Jones. That was Hines who came over late. And a big gainer with the penalty.
Right here, out of bounds. 15-yard penalty.
Well, it turns out to be a 30-yard gain when you tackle on the personal foul.
And a good job on the outside by number 82, Jonathan Thomas, getting the key block right here to allow him to get the reception and get down the field. I don't think that was that big of a deal to bump out of bounds. I mean, come on. It is football, Sean. I mean, he didn't take him out. I mean, let the guys play a little bit.
You're saying that's a Tallahassee and Daytona Beach greeting right there.
Absolutely.
These guys don't get to see each other all that much throughout the course of the year.
They're coming with the fast flags early in the ballgame.
Rattlers rush four again. Same play. It's Jones, and he makes a defender miss. Spins inside the 30 to the 28. Nice move as he was able to shake free of Wilson. Elijah Jones drops him, but not before Jones gets fined. There is an injured Rattler down as well. That's Haisley, the starting middle linebacker. It is Jabril Haisley down into the turf. An injury timeout. Bethune-Cookman with the lead, but they're on the march when we return to Orlando.
Dream of becoming a trauma surgeon.
Jabril Haisley able to walk off on his own power, and that's a big cog in the center of that defense. He is only a freshman, but he's one of the top tacklers and a position grouping as a whole that's very young. They need a healthy Haisley if they're to knock off Bethune-Cookman today, and he was able to walk off on his own power.
Well, he took a shot to the left knee from a helmet, and you see him trying to shake it off. Hopefully get back in the ballgame very soon. And for all our viewers, the reason why we're on hold right now, they're taking a look to see if this was a targeting play by number 10, Orlando McKinley. If you watch him on this play, he comes up right here. He's coming up, and he leads with the hit with the crown of his helmet. So it'll be interesting to see what they say on this call, because by definition, when you lead with the crown of your helmet, that's considered targeting.
After further review, replay has determined that number 10 for Florida A&M has committed a targeting foul. Number 10 has been disqualified from the game, penalized half the distance from the goal, to your automatic first down.
moment of feel for that young man, Orlando McKinley, in the situation. But with the targeting call, that is an automatic ejection. It's a dangerous hit involving the launching.
And right
in this
here,
case, forcible hit by the crown of the helmet.
Absolutely. That is the case on that play. You cannot lead with the crown of your helmet, and it was a forcible lead. It was something that he chose to do. And they're trying to do this for the safety of the players and the safety of the game. And you understand it. For the Florida A&M fan base, they may be a little disappointed and frustrated, but this is for the safety of the players.
Yeah, we are talking about the lack of depth at linebacker, and they're not real deep in that secondary either. Tyler Woodley is going to have to step up for McKinley's absence, and precarious situation for Alex Wood and the Rattlers. First and 10 after the targeting call, Bethune-Cookman right back to work inside the red zone. From the 14-yard line, it will be Brim on a keeper as a running back was just absolutely destroyed. Elijah Price.
And people, this is what you call bringing and delivering the people's elbow. Watch Price right here, number 90. He comes around and he crushes the running back on this play. Absolutely, boom, right there. That is called the people's elbow. And I tell you what, they will be watching out for him moving forward.
Tupac Ishmi was at the wrong end of that people's elbow. Brim again keeps it. He's running for his life, slips free from a couple of Rattlers and is pushed out of bounds. Good pursuit defense. It was Wilson who was in on the stop as Brim scrambles for 2 yards, setting up a third down.
And right now, Florida A&M is bringing pressure from the outside, from the inside. They're not allowing Brim to go anywhere with the football. A good job in coverage on the back end. Brim has nowhere to go with the football. Williams has nowhere to go with the football. Let's see what they pull out of their bag of tricks on third down. They have to be very careful because you still, if you don't get the touchdown or the first down, want to be in a position to kick a field goal.
Williams will have three receivers to the right, one split left. They're going to move the pocket. Little misdirection on the inside draw, and a good open field tackle is made by Terry Jefferson.
And that's a safe play for Bethune-Cookman because you want to put yourselves or stay in a position to get a field goal. You want to put points on the board. Safe play. They got the linebackers flowing one way. But like you said, a good job by Terry Jefferson, the strong safety, to come up in field and make the tackle.
Uriel Hernandez on for the field goal. This will be a 31-yard attempt for Hernandez, the junior from Homestead, Florida. Anthony Cruz, the holder from the near hash. Snap is good. The kick is on the way. And it is good as he sneaks it through the right upright. Pushing and shoving afterward, but it's Bethune-Cookman smiling right now. They go back up 7. Tampa and Church Street swallowed up with Rattler and Wildcat fans today, tailgating outside of Camping World Stadium, downtown Orlando. What a setting. Bethune-Cookman, Florida A&M, and the Wildcats lead by 7. Alongside Forrest Conley, Sean Kenny, welcoming you back. And so far, high-energy game, the passion from the fans outside. This is what this classic is all about. It's going to get noisy in about 10 minutes as well with the Battle of the Bands coming up. Past the 20, up to the 24-yard line, the Rattlers will open up shop. Well, they've been playing this one since 1929. Tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. Number 11 USC hosts UCLA at the Coliseum. Josh Rosen against Sam Darnold. The victory bell on the line with the Trojans winning the last two meetings and looking to keep their college football playoff hopes alive. Streaming live tonight on the ESPN app. But he got that one for us.
I don't know. You know, Darnold and Rosen, you don't know. You don't know which one's going to show up. They both have showed up sometimes this season. Sometimes they haven't. You know, it's one of those games like this game. It's just a rivalry, but the difference in that rivalry is in the same town in Los Angeles. So it's a battle for Los Angeles.
From the 24, Stanley had an initial time. Now he's flushed by Ford. Throws to the tight end, Desmond Nord, and he makes the catch. Out at the 39-yard line, the ability of both these quarterbacks to stretch out the play, huge in the passing game.
But what I like about both quarterbacks is they not only extend plays, they continue to look down the field for the vertical pass while they're scrambling and getting outside the pocket. That is key.
Stanley is a two-year starter despite the sophomore tag. He had the most experience among the returning quarterbacks. Threw for 1,300 yards last year. On first down, this running game has not been able to get much. Devin Bowers falls ahead for 3 yards. Tackled by Uriah Gilbert to pick up a two. Bowers has been banged up throughout the course of the season. He's had a good year rushing for over 600 yards, and that hasn't happened all that much. He's the first 500-yard rusher since 2012 for this FAMU program. They put Nord in as the H-back, and they run toward the boundary side looking for a cutback lane. Is Hinrinless as he busts in to the 47.
And Lubin's Polonese, number 61, did an excellent job on the outside with that block. He was able to maintain that block. He didn't hold. That's what I like about him. See him right here, the right tackle. Good job. Stretch, 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 stretch. That's what you have to do. You can't tug. Good job by Lubin's Polonese on the outside to spring his back.
A situation there where it's okay. You got beat pad level. Clearly, Ford was underneath the pads, but he held his ground.
Absolutely. You got to fight that outside shoulder.
Third down and short. Nice out route. Knowing where the sticks were, Kareem Smith makes the catch and a first down.
And I've been impressed so far with Florida A&M's ability to give Stanley a pocket to throw out of. Now, he's been forced out of the pocket a couple of times, but for the most part, they've held strong at the point of attack at the line of scrimmage and given him a clear pocket to pass the football.
Offensive line that features two seniors, a sophomore, a junior, and a true freshman. First and 10 from the 49. Stanley is not going to get away this time, and down he goes. Marquez Ford with the sack for Bethune-Cookman, a loss of 7.
And I don't blame that on Lubin's Polonese. I think Stanley held on to the football a little bit too long, but he had nowhere to go. Now, they give him a good pocket right here. 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 4 seconds. You've got to get rid of the football. You cannot expect your offensive lineman to block for 5 seconds. You've got to get rid of the football. So I put that sack on Stanley.
Ford originally was recruited by Rutgers, spent a year with the Scarlet Knights in 2015, never stepped on the field. He utilized his redshirt year. Brings a unique set of skills to this defense.
Timeout, Florida A&M. This is the second time out of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
And after the sack, Stanley will use FAMU's second timeout, leaving them with one remaining. 3:13 to go in this first half, and we talked about throwing out the records in this game. Bethune-Cookman coming in on a roll, FAMU reeling a little bit. These two rivals, you knew both teams would put forth their best, and down 7, the Rattlers have to like where they're sitting right now.
Well, I'll give you a perfect example. Earlier in the season, we saw Florida State and Miami play. Miami was undefeated. Florida State was reeling. They had lost a couple of ball games. They had lost a key player, their quarterback. But you get into that rivalry game, and all bets are off because these are kids that played with one another. They know their strengths. They know their weaknesses. And pride steps in. It doesn't matter the records. It's all about pride and the willingness to go out there and try and be the champion.
Big difference between these two teams. Bethune-Cookman has found out a way to win the close games. That has still eluded FAMU.
Delay game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
This is the second time we've seen a penalty right after a timeout.
And that's just lack of discipline. Guys have to be ready to play.
Sure, Alex Wood wanting an explanation, maybe feeling that clock wasn't reset after the timeout. 22nd timeout. Call will stand, so it becomes second and a mile for Stanley. Bethune rushes four over the middle. Norwood the catch at the 40. Norwood to the 35. Scoops out of bounds to the 31-yard line. The safety valve in this passing attack on the drag route for the second time. It's Norwood going for good yards, 31 yards on the first down.
And that's one of those plays as a defender when you come to the sideline and the coaching staff asks you what happened. Coach, he's just too fast. Norwood right here, he gets reception, and you see him run away from the defender to get to the outside. A good job by Elliott Miller to continue pursuit, but you cannot let Norwood get free like that.
Home run ball, one-on-one toward the end zone. Caught for the touchdown, Kareem Smith.
And I tell you what, Kareem Smith is making a living in this ball game, high-pointing footballs. Number 22, Daquan Richardson, never turned around to locate the football. By the time he turned his head around, the ball was already there, and Smith was making the play on it. I saw Smith streaming down the sideline. Stanley knew exactly where he wanted to go with the football. You see him right here. Stanley knows right now where he's going with the football. He just waits, takes his time, and you see right at the end, number 22 turns around, but it's too late because the ball is already there. Good job by Stanley, and a great job by Kareem Smith, knowing when to jump and when to make the play on that football.
Made that play on one of the better defenders in the MEAC, and Richardson as well. So Florida A&M comes right back. Seven plays, 76 yards, a little under 4 minutes off the game clock. And the Rattlers have tied up Bethune-Cookman late in this first half.
And now it's interesting, Sean, we've got 2 minutes and 35 seconds left in this ball game. Bethune-Cookman has to be very careful when they get the football back.
Brian Stanley, the redshirt sophomore. He has been a marksman this year for the Rattlers. He put the ball where Smith could make a play. We're tied in Orlando. Florida A&M has battled back. They have tied Bethune-Cookman on the touchdown pass. Stanley to Smith. Coming up at halftime, a treat. The Marching 100 representing FAMU. The pride from Bethune-Cookman. It's the Battle of the Bands. We'll have the show in its entirety coming up here at the break. You won't want to miss it. Sun-drenched skies here in Orlando, a huge crowd for this Florida Classic. Bird on the return, the explosive freshman takes it out past the 20, and he's hit hard at the 24. So this becomes a big drive for Bethune-Cookman. Remember, FAMU deferred, so they're going to get the football to start the second half, and you have Larry Brim, who's been highly efficient, ready to orchestrate this two-minute drill.
But that's why Bethune-Cookman has to be very, very careful. If it's not there, if I'm the coaching staff, I'm telling Brim, just get rid of the football, throw it away, live to play the next down. I don't think this is a possession where you want to give an easy turnover, a short field to Florida A&M to try and get another score on the board. Because like you said, Sean, they come back out with the ball, they can be two scores behind before they know it.
Just haven't had a lot of change of possession. It's only the fourth drive of this first half for Bethune-Cookman. Some long drives early. Back foot throw hit as he released, and it's incomplete as he got rid of that in the nick of time.
And for Larry Brim, that is not what you want to see. You don't want to see the front of your offensive lineman's jerseys, because that means they're looking back to see where the guy that just beat them is, because he's chasing you.
Brim has been nearly perfect today, 131 yards. He has the touchdown pass. Second down and 10. Keep an eye on number 31 in the white, Antonio Miller. One of the rush-ins. It comes from the opposite side. Brim's going to launch. Deep downfield. Receiver open, but he lost his footing as Mitchell looked to make an adjustment. There is a flag down all the way back at the line of scrimmage.
And Mitchell had two people covering him, Hines and Hilton, and he was able to get behind both of those guys. That has to be a cause of concern for the Florida A&M defense.
Holding, offense, number 57. 10-yard penalty, replay second down.
And right now, the defensive line for Florida A&M has dominated the offensive line. But you see here, how does a receiver, Mitchell, get behind two defenders? The safety, Hines, has to be deep. He cannot let anything get behind him. That's why he's called the safety. You are the safety valve. You have to be deeper than anyone else.
KMU takes the penalty, so we'll replay second down. Second and 20 from the 14. Graham is going to throw it. Pressure by Miller off the edge. Mitchell goes up and makes the catch. Good safe call. Check that. That's Jawil Davis who holds it in. Stepped out of bounds at the 28, a gain of 14.
And they laid off the pressure on that play. They only rushed three. Let's see if they put four down and rush four on this play if they continue with the three-man rush and drop back into coverage with eight.
KMU with just the one timeout, so if they can get a stop here, that would give Stanley and this quick strike offense an opportunity before halftime, but they must get a stop. Third and six. They need to get it up to the 34. Francois in motion. Grimm looking for the slant on the double slant. The pass too tall as it sailed, and the Rattlers are going to get the football back.
And the dangers of throwing the football when you get an incompletion is the clock stops. So Florida A&M is able to preserve that last timeout. Now let's see if they can get good field position on this punt.
Rattler fans making some noise. Darius Smith, the emotional firecracker, one of their down linemen, came off the field. He knows that could possibly be a big stop by his defense. First punt of the day by Jabani Francis. MEAC Special Teams Performer of the Week after averaging 44 yards a boot last week in the win against North Carolina Central. One timeout, a Rattler offense on the field late in the first half from Orlando. Redshirt sophomore Ryan Stanley in this offense. Again, very productive like they have been over the second half of the season. Their last two drives have resulted in points. Can he dial up one more and give the Rattlers a lead right before halftime? Just the one timeout. Minute 25 on the clock. From the 34-yard line, Stanley looked like he wanted to take a shot downfield. Nothing open. Spins away from the initial wave and will fall ahead to the 37. And FAMU, this is not the type of start you wanted in this drive. It's a minimal game, plus that clock keeps moving.
Well, if they don't get positive yards on this play, I think they'll go ahead and settle with going into halftime with the score tied because they get the ball coming back out.
Second down throw, a juggling attempt by Murphy, and he's unable to hold it in. Forrest, you going conservative on me late in the year?
Well, you tied 10-10 in a ball game that you didn't look good early, and you get the ball coming out in the second half. The last thing that you want to do is have a mistake right here and give the ball back to Bethune before the half.
Movement up front looked like that left side. Maybe Rashad Williams, a tackle
false
flinched.
Start, offense, number 59, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Williams, a senior out of the Chicago area. Offensive line that has played well for the most part in this first half.
And let's see what Coach Sims does after this play. Does he use one of his two remaining timeouts to stop the clock to get the ball back if they're not able to get a first down?
Third down and 12. Stanley looking over the middle, rifles it, and it's knocked away. Good play by Elliott Miller as he got the hand in to defend that ball intended for Norwood.
And often you see defensive backs use that offhand to wrap around the receiver to pull themselves forward. A good job by Miller not using that offhand and knocking that ball down.
Just the second punt of the day, Chris Fadul.
And once again, because it's an incomplete pass, the clock doesn't run.
10 guys at the line of scrimmage, but they don't come after it. They're going to set up the return. Spiraling punt, fair catch signaled for. at the 25-yard line. We'll kick off your Week 11 NFL Sunday with the Countdown Crew at 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. They'll have all the early breaking stories, injury updates, and preview each game right up to kickoff, also streaming live on the ESPN app. So the 43-yard punt, Bethune-Cookman with two timeouts. 44 seconds to work. How aggressive do you play it in this situation if your coach says?
It's according to what happens on first down. First down is the key. Can you get another first down? Can you get down the field? Right now, you're too close to your own end zone to do anything dangerously.
Nickel package in. They run a twist up front. They nearly get to the quarterback, and he's forced to dump it behind the intended target, looking for Tompkins, who's trying to sneak out of the backfield.
And there has to be an adjustment made by the offensive line for Bethune-Cookman at the half, because they have not been able to block Elijah Price all afternoon. Number 90 has been a thorn in their side. He is coming off the edge. He is making the tackles open up prematurely. They have to do a better job. They've either got a chip or they've got to leave a tight end on that side to help block Price.
Yeah, this front three of Price, Miller, and Smith have had a good first half. Lots of room over the middle. They hook up with Davis, picks up a nice downfield block, and Davis will stop the clock as he gets out of bounds at the 40. 15 yards in the completion to Joel Davis.
And a good adjustment on that play by the offensive line. The guard went out and helped the tackle to block Price on that play, and I think they're going to have to continue to do that if they want to be successful passing the football down the field.
If you're thinking about a field goal for Uriel Hernandez, his long this year is 42. On first down, they move the pocket. Brim throws, and taking his eye off the football, and incomplete was Frank Brown. You don't see that too often. Brown is about as sure as handed as they come, the fifth-year senior, second-team All-MEAC performer. Such an experienced receiving core with Brown and Davis, both fifth-year guys in this program. And then you factor in the junior Kevon Mitchell, who's been a contributor the past 2 years, making his 25th career start today. Nice luxury to have if you're Larry Brim. Second down, Brim over the middle, takes a shot. This time hanging on is Brown. You love to see that with the quarterback going right back to the receiver. Brown hauls it in at a first down.
And you see the offense sprint up to the line of scrimmage. They're either going to clock it or they're going to try and get down the field. They want to preserve the timeouts.
Cooker. Is there a second timeout of the half? Be a 30-second timeout.
You see Brim do a good job of climbing the pocket and finding his big play receiver Brown down the field.
Game clock to 18 seconds.
Brown did a good job of squeezing that football after the previous miss. And if you're Florida A&M, you don't mind giving up stuff in the middle of the field because you force them to either use a timeout or come
Please
and clock
reset
it.
The game clock to eight. Thank you.
You don't want to give up anything on the sideline because they can get out of bounds and stop the clock without using their timeout. Because they were in the middle of the field, Bethune-Cookman had to use one of their two remaining timeouts. So now you want to keep everything in front of you. Once again, your deep safeties have to be deeper than anybody else. You can't let anybody get behind you.
Don't forget, moments away from probably the best halftime entertainment in all of college football. The bands are getting ready. The marching 100 for FAMU, the pride, Bethune-Cookman coming up the entire show here at halftime. Brim on first down over the middle. That's where FAMU is conceding some yards. Pass is caught. Does not look like they pick up the first down, so the clock's going to keep moving, and that forces the Wildcats to use their timeout.
It'll be a 30-second timeout.
And that's exactly what Florida A&M wanted to do. We'll give you everything in the middle. We'll give you everything underneath. You can run as long as you want to. We just want to keep you in bounds and keep you behind the sticks.
So if they don't pick up another ounce, they'd be looking at a 45-yard field goal for Hernandez, who has a strong enough leg. We talked about it to start this drive. 42 was his career long, and he hit that earlier this year. And he's only attempted a couple of field goals from beyond 40 yards.
And for Bethune-Cookman, you cannot get a reception inbounds and not get out of bounds. It's either got to be to the end zone or to the sideline. If Florida A&M is able to keep them inbounds, the clock will run out. They won't have time to get the kicker out.
Hernandez getting loose just in case his number is called. First down from the 28. Play fake. Brim under pressure. Hit as he throws, and it's incomplete. That time the pressure came from Vandrick Verdier, the backup defensive end out of Miami.
And I think this is going to be an intentional grounding because there was no receiver in the area, and he was inside the tackle box.
Intentional grounding. Offense. Ball be placed at the spot of the foul. The down is a loss of down. By rule, there's also a 10-second runoff of the game clock. The half is over.
Wow.
And the key to that, he was inside the tackle box, and there was no receiver where he threw the football. You cannot do that. They lost an opportunity to try to get a score on the board before the half.
Stay tuned for halftime. Scores, updates, features, along with stats, analysis, and highlights of this game, plus the battle of the bands. It's all coming up right after these messages from Orlando and the Florida Classic. Time here in Orlando. Welcome back to the Florida Blue Florida Classic. It's time now for the Battle of the Bands, and let's start with FAMU, Florida A&M, and the Marching 100.
Thank you.
time in Orlando, and we're just getting started. Part two of the Battle of the Bands, ready to go. It's Bethune-Cookman and the Pride. Enjoy. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the 2017 Florida Classic presented by McDonald's. An electric atmosphere here in Orlando. Halftime, the Battle of the Bands wrapping up, and a good one on the gridiron between these two longtime Sunshine State rivals. We're deadlocked in a 10-all tie. Bethune-Cookman was able to get it going early and frequently on offense thanks to the accuracy of Larry Brim. The short passing game for us, able to open up a shot downfield. And this starter who has a lot of experience showing that in this big game.
Well, he got the quick passing game going, and that started to sell the linebackers. And then they were able to pull that right tackle. It froze those linebackers, allowed the tight end to get behind him, and you see the easy pitch and catch for the score for Bethune-Cookman.
Jaquan Loomis, the tight end, with the touchdown reception. One guy not frozen in the spotlight of this big moment, the young sophomore Ryan Stanley. A very cool 9 of 14, and he showed the touch with those crossing patterns the entire first half.
Well, Norwood has not been able to be stopped coming across in those crossing patterns, and just when you think you got him covered, he goes down the field vertical, and Smith high points the football once again, able to make the great catch to get the touchdown for Florida A&M.
Both these quarterbacks enter the MEAC as some of the best percentages in completion in the conference, and they have lived up to that. Stanley 9 of 14 for 151 yards, the big numbers put up by Brim, each with a touchdown. However, both defenses doing a nice job containing the ground game. Both these quarterbacks elusive.
And you say containing, you see right here and right here, -7, -4 yards. They're not allowing the quarterbacks to get vertical when they scramble outside of the pocket. That's key. You don't want to give them first downs. I think what I see as an advantage right now is Florida A&M's defensive line, their defensive ends, especially number 90, Elijah Price, has been a problem throughout the first half. Let's see what they do with their second half adjustments. Will they chip him? Will they use the guard and send the guard out? Will they also, you know, bring a tight end on that side? Because if they don't, Elijah Price will be a problem throughout the second half, this ability to rush the passer.
Don't forget the ESPN app is a fan's best friend. Stream every ESPN and ABC college football game live at home or on the go. You'll get access to scores, news, and highlights all season long. Download the ESPN app to start streaming right now. Both teams certainly want to clean up the penalty situation. FAMU, 9 penalties for 77 yards. Bethune-Cookman, 6 penalties for 35 yards. And we saw that killer intentional grounding right before halftime, which wiped out a possible opportunity to get 3 late in that first half.
Well, I think both teams have had some killer penalties. You talk about early in the game, Florida A&M on the second play of the game had a safety that was taken away from them because of the face mask penalty. And then Bethune-Cookman is in a position to possibly kick a field goal and go up 13-10 at the half, but they get that intentional grounding. Those are key plays, and that's points taken off the board.
Neither team has been able to get the ground game going. FAMU just 36 rushing yards. Bethune-Cookman netted only 6 yards in that first half. It will be Devin Bowers in the pistol. On first down, Stanley's going to go to the airwaves. Hitch pattern is caught. Slipping free is Shavis Murphy. And Murphy, the giant target at 6'6", sprints his way to first down yardage. Take a look at the numbers in the first half. The penalties are certainly glaring, but both teams having success through the air.
Well, Florida A&M has been able to establish a little bit of a running game, and I think that helps them as opposed to Bethune-Cookman. Only 6 yards rushing. They have to get some type of running game going.
18-yard gain on first down. Stanley will check down as he looks over toward the sideline. Both these teams comfortable at going at various speeds offensively. We'll see them line up and go right away or use all of that play clock. Bowers searching for any type of crevice, cannot find any.
And you see Florida A&M running the read option. Stanley is continuing to leave the ball in the back's belly. Eventually, he's going to read that defensive end crashing down. He's going to squeeze that football, pull it out of the back's belly, and get around the edge. So Bethune-Cookman has to be very careful with their defensive ends. They've got to stay home. You can't go flying down and give him a short corner.
Second down and 11. Bethune brings the blitz. It's picked up nicely. Now busting through the middle is Howard. That forces Stanley from the pocket. He'll launch deep downfield into the setting sun here and knocked away. They were looking for Chad Hunter. Good defensive play by Richardson. And Forrest Hunter is a guy that we were both expecting big things from, the talented freshman, team leader in yards per catch, averaging close to 17 yards, but they've done a nice job really taking him out of the offense.
Yes, they have, and for Hunter, you've just got to continue to play. Hunter's a freshman. You've got to continue to play, continue to push, and your time will come, your opportunities will come. You cannot get frustrated if you're Hunter.
Third down and 11, Bethune rushes four. Stanley, that one got away from him, incomplete. He was looking for Andrew Davis, but a flutter right when it left his right hand.
The one thing we didn't see is the crossing routes that have been very successful for Florida A&M. Brandon Norwood has been successful with that crossing route, whether it be a shallow or a deep crossing route. They have to get back to what they've been successful with.
Faduel on the punt for the third time. It's Frank Brown awaiting the kick back inside his 20. Faduel with a beautiful kick, high spiraling kick, and Brown mishandles in the goal line, hesitates, and a special teams mistake by the veteran return man. For the second time in this football game, Bethune-Cookman will be working from their own shadows of their own goal line. Special teams mistake with that sun here in Orlando. Brown and the Wildcats in a precarious situation when we return.
As for my own home projects, luckily.
You're looking at my favorite place on this earth, Gatorland, here in Orlando. An up-close look at some of the friendly reptiles that you will encounter. Saltwater crocodiles, alligators 15 to 18 feet long. They have it all at Gatorland, one of the local attractions here in the Sunshine State. Had a chance to go behind the scenes with the folks at Gatorland with last trip into Orlando, and you know what the favorite food on the Gators' diet is, besides Forrest Conley and Sean Kenny?
I don't know, but
hot
I know.
Dogs.
But I know one. I know human is on on the menu.
No, they so just I'm like not, those chicken hot dogs.
But they like human too, so I'm not going to go hang out.
But again, I can never get Forrest to go on a kayak trip with
me. Reading is fundamental, and you saw that sign. You will be eaten. I am not interested in being gator soup. I'm cool on that.
Every time you make a trip to Gator Waters, I always offer the invitation to Big Foe to hop in the kayak with me.
Absolutely.
And every time you
not.
Turn me down.
Absolutely not. I'm not that adventurous. I watched the Nature Channel. I'm good on that, man.
Speaking of adventurous, let's see how Bethune-Cookman plays it here. Third down and three. The ball just past the 10-yard line. Three receivers set. Play action, Brim over the middle, diving attempt, and it's incomplete. Good defense by Tyler Woodley as he timed the contact beautifully.
And although they did not get the first down, they did a good job of getting out of the shadow of their goal line, giving the punter some more room to punt the football. It's a huge difference punting right inside the goal line as opposed to punting at the back line.
Francis has a strong leg. Talked about MEAC Special Teams Performer of the Week last week, averaging 44 yards a kick. Let's see if he can uncork a bomb here. Smith awaiting the kick near midfield. And he does. My goodness, what a kick by Francis. A field position changer as he drove it right over the shoulder top of Kareem Smith. And both punters coming through clutch early on in this third quarter.
Absolutely. You couldn't ask for anything better from your punter. He flipped the entire field with that kick. And you know, we always talk about kickers. I always say the same thing. Kickers matter. And you see right there, what a great kick to flip the field.
62-yard punt by Francis. Remember, Faduel for FAMU had just kicked 152 yards prior to that. So the defense of the punters early on, series number two of this third quarter. They run to the boundary side. A little bit of a hole opens up, twisting his way out past the 35, up to the 36 goes the slippery Devin Bowers. Fresh frustrating first half for Bowers. Just 5 carries, 13 yards today for the team's leading rusher on the season. 2 years ago, he was the FAMU MVP of this Florida Classic as he had a big day running against this Wildcat defense. Not the case, though, here in 2017. Second and a yard. They will run the jet sweep. Marcus Williams stretching to the outside. Second and third effort. He'll pick up the first down.
And you see just a little bit of hesitation by Williams to make the defender stop. And once that defender reacted to that hesitation, Williams was able to get around the edge and get the first down. Watch the hesitation. You see the jet sweep right here. Now watch as he gets to the edge and he comes to the right there. Just a little bit of hesitation. He was able to get around the defender, Kennedy and Duqueway, to get the first down.
First and 10 as they bring Henryless into the backfield, running over the left guard. Henryless snowed under at the 48. It's a nice 1-2 punch, both underclassmen. When you talk about Bowers and Henryless, more the inside the tackles type of runner with the redshirt freshman from Lincoln High School in Miami. There is quite a Miami flair and flavor to this FAMU roster. Second and 6. Sniffing midfield, the Rattlers. Second straight call, patient run by Henryless as he stretches toward the first down marker. About a yard shy for Henryless, setting up a third and short.
And Florida A&M is getting exactly what they want offensively. You get 4 yards on first down, 4 yards on second down. You put yourselves in third and short. That's exactly what the coaching staff wants to see. Now you open up the playbook. You can go at the play action because the defense has to react to the ball fake, because this is the down where you can run football for the first down.
They don't go jumbo package a lot, but they're going to do it here and go under center. Two tight ends, third down and short, and they go with the halfback pass, and the ball is tipped around and intercepted by Richardson. Penalty flag down for the running back through the football.
First down, timeout.
And it's the ball hawk in the secondary for the defense coming up with the game's first turnover. FAMU into the bag of tricks. It backfires. Bethune-Cookman with the momentum and the ball. Daquan Richardson with his team-leading fourth interception of the year prior to the start of this season, placed on the watch list for the Black College Football Player of the Year, one of 50 athletes on that list, and he has been the main weapon in that secondary as we go back and take another look.
Well, you see the tight end number 85, Desmond Nord. They go with the ball fake right here, Bowers, but he doesn't put enough on it, so Nord is reaching back, but the play is made by number 24, Sam Mark, getting his right hand in there, knocking the ball up, which allows Daquan Richardson to make the interception. Watch 24 right here. That hand right there, that tips the ball over to his teammate Richardson to get the interception.
Yeah, Mark making just the second start of his career, the redshirt freshman thrust into the line of fire because of injuries. Williams in at quarterback, and he's looking at a third down and 7. Bethune-Cookman still looking for their first down of this second half. Williams has not been able to do much when he's been in there, just 2 of 3 for 9 yards. -2 rushing yards, and that play clock winding down. Inside 10 seconds, Williams gets the relay. He has Michael Jones as the running back in the pistol. The tight end is Loomis as the H-back to the right. They pull him, roll out that side, little bootleg action. Williams throws on the run, and a drop by Davis. Frustrated Jawil Davis, fifth-year senior, and Bethune-Cookman forced a punt again.
And you have to wonder if the FAMU sideline had something to do with Davis dropping that football. I'm sure they were making all kinds of noises and trying to get him to look over and just get his concentration off just a little bit. He allowed the ball to get you know, in between his hands and to his body. You've got to squeeze that football. You can't body catch those passes. That was a first down for Bethune-Cookman if he makes that reception.
So here's Francis again, just off the heels of a 62-yard kick. Line drive, returnable option here for Kareem Smith at the 23. Hop skips through a little hole, up past the 30 to the 33-yard line. They've been playing this one since 1929. Tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific, a big one on the West Coast on ABC as number 11 USC hosts UCLA at the Coliseum. Josh Rosen, Sam Darnold, the Victory Bell on the line, with the Trojans winning the last two meetings and looking to keep their college football playoff hopes alive. Streaming live on the ESPN app. And you take a look at these two guys when they are on. There is probably nobody more fun to watch than either of these guys, but the question becomes when they're on.
Well, Rosen had a huge ball game against Texas A&M in the opening season, which had him as the front runner after game one for the Heisman Trophy. He simmered down a little bit. That Memphis loss hurt that UCLA ball club. And for Sam Darnold, I think he's thrown more interceptions than I thought we would see from him. He hasn't been as efficient as he was coming into this season. He was the odds-on favorite to be the number one pick. I think now this is one of those games where a lot of scouts will watch to see how both of these guys respond.
Combined 45 touchdown passes between those two stars. Speaking of stars, Kareem Smith is down right now for FAMU. Smith, a senior out of Haines City, Florida.
And the way they're massaging his calves, it looks like he's just cramping up right now. He's got to get more fluids in his body. They're trying to massage it out right now. If you've never experienced this, this is extremely painful. Your muscles lock up because there's no water. And, you know, it's not very hot. There's some humidity in the stadium. But you think about all the adrenaline going for these kids out here playing this ball game. You see his legs right there. He's just trying to stretch it out. And so they're going to stretch him out. They're going to probably, they may even do IVs if it's intense enough.
Take another look at happened on the return. Smith, who has been the favorite target for Stanley today with the four catches, 70 yards, and that terrific touchdown catch, but he's going to head over to the trainer's table. We'll keep an eye on that.
But he's got to get fluids in him. He's got to stretch, stretch, stretch.
FAMU from the 32 on first down, trying to stretch it to the outside as Bowers slipped a little bit. Bowers cuts in for two hard-fought yards. All of a sudden, in this third quarter, we're starting to see both defenses settle in. Devin James, the inside linebacker, is a true freshman out of Treasure Coast High School. Part of a young linebacking corps when you factor in Hendricks, who's in his first year transitioning from the junior college ranks. Like there was movement, but no flag as Bowers hits the hole hard. Now a flag is thrown as it looked like Bethune was into the neutral zone. Henriles picks up first down yardage, or at least close to it.
Offside. Defense, number 53. That penalty's declined. First down.
And I think what you saw in that play is the defense reacting. They knew they were offsides, and they were kind of slow to get to the football as the ball was snapped because you're so concentrated on getting back on sides. As you're moving back, the ball is snapped, and the offense is moving towards you.
See, Bethune has really struggled. They cannot get anything going on the ground. The Rattlers having a little bit more consistent success running the football. Program that has had some good running backs through the years. Al Frazier back in the 50s, Ike Williams, Michael Solomon, some good names. Deep ball, looking for Norwood, and he cannot get by Elliott Miller, and here comes a late flag. Norwood trying to make a move back toward the football. Miller prevented that, and a real late flag, and a visibly upset Terry Sims.
And it's going to be interesting to see what they call on this play, because both players should have an opportunity to make a play on the football. And it looked like Norwood was trying to fight through the defender.
These two have been going toe-to-toe all day.
There is no foul for defensive pass interference. Second down.
And I like the no call on that play. Both guys are looking back for the football. I think the key to that is Miller looked back. If Miller didn't look back, then it could have been a penalty, but he's looking back, so he's trying to make a play on the ball. And you see Norwood as well trying to make a play on the football, so I like the no call. That's just two guys outside competing.
Murphy goes in motion. They run the opposite way, and a big hole for Hinrichs, and maybe a touchdown-saving tackle made by Marquez Ford.
And this is the second time on this drive they've had what you call a touchdown saving tackle, because the seas are parting right here. You see Bowers get the football, and there's no one at the third level. If the second level defender right here doesn't make the play right here, that's a touchdown. You see right there, boom, there's no one else there. He has all this to run the football.
Big third down for FAMU. Stanley feeling the heat, rifles it near side. Coming back to the football is Williams, and he'll make the catch. Took it away from Joseph Johnson, the safety. First down, yardage, a pickup of 16.
And Stanley's doing a good job of placing the football where his receivers and only his receivers can make a play on it. You see Bethune defenders around him, but he's putting the football in the right places.
Stanley was one of Woods' top recruits in 2015, which was Woods' first recruiting class. An up and down season, but certainly more ups than downs for Ryan Stanley, and the sophomore putting on another solid performance guiding this offense today. 11 of 18 for 185. Keeps the drive alive. They'll stretch it to Hinrichs with some space inside the 20. Hinrichs finally tackled by Johnson, but not before he plows his way inside the red zone. And the Rattlers have it cooking here in this third quarter. 17 more yards.
And you see everything you want to see from a back on this play. You see vision. You see ability to stop and cut right here. He stops. He cuts. He gets north and south. You see vision to cut it back. Now you're seeing power and his ability to have balance and get down the field and carry tacklers to get extra yards.
Boy, you hate to see this if you're Bethune-Cookman. Your leader, Daquan Richardson.
And I think it's cramping once again. You know, once again, when you talk about adrenaline, and it's not as hot as it could be out here, but adrenaline gets the lather going. You start to sweat, and you've got these guys running around and playing in a ball game, and this is the part of the game where you start to see guys get cramped up. So they're going to stretch him out on the sideline. They're going to get fluids in him. Hopefully they'll be able to get him back in this series, if not, maybe the next series.
Florida A&M getting close to crossing that 100-yard plateau. First down inside the red zone. They will run the jet sweep. Shaking free from one is Williams, and he's able to scoot ahead toward the 10. Tell you what, this kid is quick. The sophomore from Northwestern High School picks up five.
But you've got to make the tackles when you're in position. Number 55, Todney Evans, had an opportunity to make a play. He allowed the back to get away from him. You cannot allow them to get away from you. You've got to make that tackle. You're the last line of defense on that edge.
Second down and five. They keep the pistol intact. They run the tunnel screen. Norwood makes the juggling catch, but it is sniffed out beautifully. That time, Jerome Howard able to read that play, and Howard gets there from his nose position.
And I tell you what, that was a bad read by Ryan Stanley. If he looks to the outside, Hinrichs is wide open over here. Nobody goes with him. Watch when the ball is snapped. Nobody's there. All he has to do is throw the ball to Hinrichs, and you've got him outside one-on-one with the defender.
Hinrichs, a late checkout. He leaves the lineup. They bring in Ray for the first time. It's Azonde Ray, the redshirt freshman, to the right of Stanley. Third down and five. It's a quarterback draw all the way. He'll follow a Ray lead. Stanley looking to stretch that football north-south, and it looks like they're going to mark him just shy of the first down. So a decision for Alex Wood. Do you take the sure three with the chip shot field goal, or do you put some trust on the big five up front and go for it?
I tell my offensive line, this is what you practice hard for. This is why we hit the sled. This is the big challenge. You want to win this ball game. You want to stop this winning streak from Bethune-Cookman. Give me a first down on this play. This is the challenge. Accept the challenge. For the offensive lineman, you've got to be the low man. Basically, bear crawl, get up under the defenders, uproot those guys.
It will be Bowers and a penalty flag thrown before the snap. A flag before the snap. As FAMU went Wildcat.
And it looks like Bethune-Cookman has, do they have 12 people on the field?
Illegal substitution, defense. They had 12 players on the field with the snap. Half the distance to the goal when he's on the first down.
And this is a big, big mistake. You cannot make this type of error. Now you've given Florida A&M a first and goal inside the 5-yard line. You talk about game-altering penalties. We've had a couple of those this ball game.
10th play of the drive for Ryan Stanley, and it looks like he might be audibly on first down. It's a high snap. He'll hand it to Henryless. He's going to get to the corner, and for the first time, the Rattlers snatch the lead. Touchdown, FAMU.
And that was a great job by the right tackle, Lubens Polonese. You saw him fighting across the defender's face. Watch number 61. He fights across the defender's face. He's got that inside arm. He's just fighting. That's what you do. You get that inside arm and you just fight. Allow your back to get around the edge and get to the end zone.
For the first time this afternoon, Florida A&M has snatched the lead. The Rattlers put together an impressive 10-play, 68-yard drive. It's the redshirt freshman from Miami. Rattlers go up 7. It's time now for our AT&T Field Pass as we take you to the countdown to the Celebration Bowl. A big game in Greensboro, North Carolina. A&T finishes MEAC play unblemished. They run the table as they shut out North Carolina Central. The SWAC East still to be determined. The SWAC West with Alcorn State, Grambling, and Southern play next week, November 25th. Winner of that game will get Alcorn State on the 2nd, and then the Celebration Bowl happening December 16th on ABC in beautiful brand new Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. 2 years ago, A&T won it. They beat Alcorn State 41-34 last year. The defensive game, Grambling knocking off North Carolina Central by a score of 10-9 in front of 35,000 strong. Celebration Bowl number 3. Always a treat. These two HBCUs, these two longtime rivals putting on a show today in front of 40-plus thousand in Orlando.
Now let's see how Bethune-Cookman reacts to adversity. This is the first time in this ball game that they've been behind. How will they come out offensively with this series?
Turn of 29 yards gives Bethune-Cookman the football in good position at the 30-yard line. And here comes Larry Brim in this offense. Brim has cooled off after a hot start in the first half. Just 1 of 4 in this third quarter. And as a result, the Rattlers have grabbed the lead. From the 31-yard line, they go 3-set. Jones is the running back. Loomis, who has the touchdown catch in motion from his tight end position. And on the zone read, it's Jones slicing his way to the 36. Don't you think it becomes paramount on this drive in particular for Bethune to try to get some type of resemblance of a running game going?
They absolutely have to. If you don't, you allow the defense to just sit back and play pass defense. You've got to get some type of running going. Only 16 yards so far rushing the football. That is unacceptable if you're Coach Sims and his coaching staff.
Second down, and it will be Jones. Not much there for Jones. 3 hard-fought yards. Elijah Price jumping on the pile late. Antonio Miller also in there. Miller and Price, 2 high energy guys, two very emotional players. In fact, Miller was hit with targeting 2 weeks ago in the first half. He had to sit out the second half. He's had a number of issues with personal fouls, but he's controlled that aggression today.
But what they present are speed rushers off the edge, and as an offensive tackle, in preparation for those players.
Ball loose, it's stripped, scooped up, and picked up by Florida A&M. Speak of the devil, Miller with it, running through both teammates and defenders. Flags are down all over the place. Now Miller loses it, but the Rattlers jump on. Holy cow, what a mess. You have laundry all over the field, a rugby scrum, and let's see how the officials are going to sort this out.
And it looked like Miller just ran out of gas. It's almost like he wanted to go down, but no, he couldn't go down because I could get to the end zone. Then he said, well, maybe I'm not a running back. Maybe I should go down. But no, why go down? Use my balance and stay up. And meanwhile, flags are just flying everywhere. Got to be one of the wackiest plays of the season so far. I mean, he's stumbling. He showed great balance on that play, more balance than I've seen from any one player on one play this season.
All right.
Well, it all starts right here with the big hit. Number 90, Elijah Price, his buddy on the opposite side, and he's Johnny on the spot. Now, one slip right there, right here. He's falling down, and he gets up. He's slipping. He's falling down right here. Then he gets up. He runs into his own man. He looks like he wanted to pitch the ball back, then he thought about it. He's slipping right here. He's almost falling down. Then he finally goes down, and I think he was so tired that he just let the ball go.
So Price with the forced fumble. The pickup by Antonio Milton. Still trying to get some oxygen, but his teammates won't give him any space. A big smile on his face, and we were just talking about that duo of Price and Milton.
Well, the speed off the edge as an offensive tackle, when you go into game plan for the next week and you see a smaller defender at the defensive end position, you know all week long you have to work on your first step. Your first step is the key to blocking smaller pass rushers.
There are multiple flags on the play by both teams after the interception. Personal foul, face mask, Bethune Cookman. That penalty has been declined. The legal block in the back, Florida A&M, number one. That penalty will be enforced 10 yards from the spot of the foul. After the play was over, sideline interference, Florida A&M. That'll be a 15-yard penalty enforced from the end of the play. It will be first down, Florida A&M.
Well, you need a master's degree to keep up with all of the post.
Well, my question is,
fiasco.
My question is, why would Florida A&M decline the penalty unless there was another penalty? I would accept the penalty to get some of these penalty yards that they lost back.
Well, there had to be an offsetting that he did not mention for that to be the case, for that first face mask, as you're talking about, to not be enforced.
But he said Florida A&M declined the penalty. That's interesting. Either way, Florida A&M gets the ball back, which is what they wanted ultimately. They've got really good field position. They're on the Bethune-Cookman side of the field. But what a play, once again, by Antonio Miller. I tell you what, he showed more balance, like I said, than I've seen in a while. But he also showed that he was a little bit gassed and wanted to go down, but pride just wouldn't let him go down.
Each team has coughed it up once in this third quarter. Can the Rattlers make them pay? From the 37-yard line, their best starting shape. They go back to that tunnel screen, and hello from one number 31 to another. Devin James not to be outdone by the Rattlers 31, Antonio Miller.
And I don't like the play because you lose yards. Now you're behind the sticks. You go from first and 10 now to second and 13. You put yourselves in a bad position where it's almost a must-throw situation. They need to go back to those crossing routes with Brandon Norwood. You got him in space. You got him on the run. That was where they've been really effective.
Play clock to two, down to one. Stanley just did get the snap off, a reverse pivot throw, and it's offline.
And this is not what you want to see if you're Coach Wood and the Florida A&M coaching staff. This looks like it may be a wasted opportunity. You've got to take advantage of every opportunity that's placed in front of you. They had an opportunity to go up two scores. Now, it's not over yet. They've got third down, and anything can happen on third down, but you don't want to be in third and long because they're predictive right now. You know what they're going to do. They've got to throw the football.
Perfect opportunity for Bethune to come after him. They do not, though. They rush only three. Stanley's going to step up, show that touch. Wide open receiver, and there is Chad Hunter, the explosive freshman, able to find some space and a first down catch for the young Rattler.
And that was a big mistake by the safety. They dropped too deep. I think you've got to come up to the sticks because you know that's where they're trying to get to the sticks. Third and 13, and they convert. Big conversion by Florida A&M. Now they get a new set of downs, and they're inside the red zone.
26 yards on the completion to Hunter, who came into this game averaging 18 yards per catch. He is their go-to guy. First down and 10. Inside the red zone again for the Rattlers on the zone read. The quick hitter lowering the pads is Henryless. And don't look now, but Florida A&M feeling like the favorite. They're feeling it right now. You can see the energy level on their sideline.
But what you see from Florida A&M right now is tough guy football. Square chin, line up in front of, and hit the man in front of you and knock him off the ball. That's exactly what you want from your offensive line.
See if Stanley can get one more play before the end of the quarter. He will. Second down, back pedals, throws toward the end zone, incomplete. He was looking for Kareem Smith. And that's how the third quarter will end. Buckle up, a fun finish from Orlando. And the Florida Classic, it's the defense for the Rattlers. Elijah Price, Antonio Miller, they've been too much to handle. Their power has propelled Florida A&M to the lead after three. Welcome back to the Florida Blue Florida Classic as we start quarter number four from Camping World Stadium in downtown Orlando. Pageantry all over the venue, just not inside but outside. Anticipation building for the postgame concert with T.I. But right now this Rattler rushing attack is the one putting on the show. Devin Bowers from 9 yards out. Touchdown!
Florida A&M with the Wildcat formation, and you see Bowers just will himself into the end zone. Defenders had him stopped at about the 2-yard line. He turned his back, kept his feet turning, and was able to push and thrust himself into the end zone. Right here, you go at the direct snap. Now you see right here, defenders got him right here. But you see him turn his back and just push with some help from his offensive lineman, Lubin's Polonese, number 61. He shows up once again. Big play on the previous touchdown and a big play pushing Bowers in for that touchdown.
Devin Bowers showed up as a defensive back when he first arrived with Florida A&M. He's made the transition to running back and he's finally healthy. Rattlers with 14 unanswered.
As a licensed
The 2017 Florida Classic is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it.
A lot of proud tradition between these two HBCU programs. And right now, Florida A&M with the momentum. Early on, fourth quarter, the Rattlers have outscored Bethune-Cookman 14-0 in this second half. And Devin Bowers' touchdown run just a few moments ago has FAMU believing, trying to curb a trend that has saw Bethune-Cookman dominate this series. 6 straight wins at this Florida Classic. Let's see how the Wildcats respond, and it is Bird on his feet. So penalty flag comes in. Bird upended high as he falls ahead to the 35-yard line.
And I tell you what, now the Bethune-Cookman offense plays right into FAMU's strength. Their ability to rush the pass rusher all afternoon has affected Bethune-Cookman's ability to get the ball down the field.
Going to return, personal foul, face mask, number 20, kicking feed. 15 yards left to the end of the play, first down.
We go back to the last possession. Elijah Price with the hit and strip picked up by Antonio Miller, and this set up The touchdown run by Devin Bowers and the final 3-4 yards, all determination as he was lifted up and thrown into the end zone. And Florida A&M coming into this game, a mark of 3-7 this year. And you see the game summary, what they've been able to do. Henryless close to 100 yards rushing. Price has that forced fumble. Bowers with a touchdown run. And it's been that duo in the backfield, especially in the third quarter of Bowers and Henryless, which has allowed this game to turn a little bit.
But can they block Price? That will be key to this drive and every drive moving forward for Bethune-Cookman if they want to pass the ball down the field. Number 90 against the right tackle.
Let's see if the veteran Brim, who has never lost in this game, can get something dialed. He settles for the tight end on the near side, making the catch is Loomis, his second grab of the day. And Loomis is stood up by a wave of snakes at the 44-yard line.
And that was a good job by the offensive tackles on that play to take three kick steps, and then turn and run the defenders up the field. And both defensive ends now are down for Florida A&M. Price and Miller, their two best defenders throughout this afternoon, are both down, but it looks like lower leg injuries. And you have to wonder, is this cramping something we've seen on both sides of the ball from both teams late in this ball game?
Miller walking off, but not the case for Price as they work on Elijah Price. And we're speculating, but
Those are cramps. Yeah,
those are cramps. You can tell by the way they're stretching.
When they push the heel of the foot up, they're trying to stretch that calf muscle because those muscles lock up, they ball up. There's not enough fluid in the body. So what they're going to have to do with Price and Miller is get those guys fluid. You want to get fluid in their bodies. If it gets too intense, then you can go the next step, which is an IV, to get more fluids in. But you see guys starting to fall to the wayside because of the humidity, because of the intensity, because of the adrenaline.
Several cramps here in the second half, and let's see if Price can work it out. Our Week 11 Monday Night Football matchup is the Battle of the Birds. Matt Ryan and the Atlanta Falcons at 5-4 matchup against Russell Wilson and the 6-3 Seahawks at the link. Seattle has an 11-game win streak on Monday nights. The record, the Raiders, they won 14 in a row. Monday Night Countdown kicks off the coverage at 6 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. A good one, Atlanta and Seattle this coming Monday night. Now the cramps have been worked out, and one of the main disruptors for FAMU is able to walk off on his own power, and Elijah Price, one of the team leaders, just not of this defense, but in the MEAC. Last year, he just torched defenses, had over 16 tackle for losses.
Now with both ends out, let's see what the backups are able to do, if they're able to get pressure on Brown.
Second down and 2 from the 44. And Brown on the zone read will keep it, able to get to the outside. Tripped up as he picks up the first down. Lasso down by Andrew Hines for the first down, a run of 4. And Bethune-Cookman lining up, ready to go quickly. Still lots of time, of course. We were talking about this. This is a situation both teams have been in this year. FAMU, they have led a number of games going into the fourth quarter, unable to finish. For Bethune-Cookman, they've rallied from a lot of games this year from third quarter deficits.
Well, if you're the Bethune-Cookman alumni and fan base, you want to see something reminiscent of last week where they were able to get that last second touchdown on the Hail Mary to win the ball game. You want to see a replica of that as this game moves forward. But I think for Bethune, they did not take advantage when you had Price out of the game. Now he comes back in after two plays out. He's got fresh legs coming off that edge. It'll be interesting because they left the tackle alone on the outside on that island to block him the last time he was in the ball game. Will they do that? And if they do, I expect them to go with the quick pass game, because if you don't pass the ball quickly, Price has shown an ability to continue to disrupt what they want to do on the outside.
Yardage dominated by FAMU. Brim's going to step up, avoids Price, being pursued by Smith, and he throws a strike at the 25, a first down for Bethune-Cookman. And there is some of the poise, the athleticism of a veteran signal caller.
And you see what Brim did on that play. He didn't get overexcited. He didn't panic. He stepped up in the pocket. He moved around a little bit. He allowed himself to have a little bit of time. He bought more time to get the ball down the field. Something both of these quarterbacks do a very good job of when they're moving around in the pocket is keeping their eyes down the field, looking for the vertical pass game.
Brim, 19 of 26 for 215 yards. He'll move the pocket to the wide side, throw in the run, juggling catch, and did he get control? No. Mitchell cannot corral it. Tried to make the lasso, juggling grab, and it'll be second down and 10.
And I like to play sprint Brim outside of the pocket, buying more time. It was a designed sprint quarterback throw on that play. You buy him more time.
Such a big first half. All of his catches coming in the first quarter. 5 catches for 44 yards. He's been quiet since. Who will step up for this Bethune-Cookman offense? Second down and 10. Brim sets it on the hitch. Caught by Davis. Slips free. Stretches ahead. And he's out of bounds inside the 5. Wilson pushed him out. But a quick move, electric first step by Jarrell Davis.
And they're taking advantage of Troy Hilton, who's in there replacing Orlando McKinley, who was thrown out of the game for targeting. Troy Hilton has to get on top of the receiver. You cannot back off at the snap of the football. You can't run a bail technique. You're giving them the first down. You've got to get up in his face, play him, bump him off the line of scrimmage. You can't give free releases.
2 tight ends, they go full house set, and they will hand it off on the stretch play, running over that power right side, and FAMU stiffens with some resistance. In the middle of the pile was Elijah Watkins.
And the one thing that the Florida A&M defense knows is this is 4 down territory for Bethune-Cookman. They know that they've got to get 2 touchdowns. They've got to start here by trying to get a touchdown. I think a field goal is out of the question. It's not in the thinking process of the coaching staff. They need to get a touchdown.
Concerned look on Alex Wood. He has watched his team put forth a dominant second half effort, but now Bethune-Cookman on the doorstep, and they have thrived inside the red zone this year. Second and goal from the 5. Pressure comes, slant pattern and heavy traffic, and it's knocked away. They were looking for that Davis-Milton matchup, as you talked about a few moments ago.
And Hilton does a good job on that play, getting the hand in there and knocking the ball up. The ball was in the air for a little while. I think if the defenders would have turned around, somebody might have been able to make a play. But watch Hilton on this play. You see him on the outside at the top of the screen right here. He does a good job. He sees where the receiver's going, and he sticks that hand in there. Actually, the ball was thrown behind. But I think Brim did a good job because you had number 9, Andrew Hines, coming across. And if he throws the ball where it should have been thrown, it could have been an INT.
Third and goal. They move it left. Now they're going to move it right. Brim trying to follow his big tackle, Norman, into the end zone. Dives ahead. Touchdown, Bethune-Cookman.
Starts with escapability. They sprint Brim out of the pocket to the left side of the field. And let's see, we've got a call here. It looks like there's a flag on the play. Actually, it isn't.
Larry Brim able to find pay dirt from 5 yards out. The all-important point after is up, and it's through by Hernandez. 9 plays, 52 yards. Brim's a guy who can beat you in a lot of different ways. This time he uses his feet. Some life for Bethune-Cookman. Back with him, 1 possession. Even though Florida A&M leads the all-time series quite substantially, it's been Bethune-Cookman who has dominated through the past decade. The last time the Rattlers were able to knock off Bethune happened all the way back in 2010. A blending of the aerial assault with some power football early in the game allowed the Rattlers to open up a lead a lead they would not relinquish as they put the finishing touches in late in the third quarter and celebrated a 38-27 win over Bethune-Cookman. And now here we are 7 years later in Orlando, and Alex Wood and his Rattlers in a position to try to get that trend back in the orange and green and try to erase the frustrations of years past. Short kick on the return from the 10-yard line is Smith, and then he is hammered. Big time hit by special teams, and Florida A&M will have it on the return of 20 yards. Big hit that time being put on by Deonto Mayer. To go back for the touchdown, and this was all Larry Brim forced.
Well, he did a good job of not trying to force it on that play, and he fights back across the field. He knows he's not going to get to the edge, so he pushes his lineman, puts his head down, and gets to the end zone. Great decision-making by Brim in several areas of that play. First, not to throw the football. Second, not to stretch it to the end, but turn up the field and get the touchdown.
Well, the million-dollar question for the Wildcats, can they stop this suddenly potent ground game from FAMU? Going to get a shot as they stretch it to Hinderless over the left side. And he is lassoed out of bounds. Good pursuit defense by Joseph Johnson as he was able to shed the block from the tight end north.
What the defense did good on that play is they never gave up the edge. So Hinderless was never able to really plant his foot and get north and south like he'd like. He was only able to get 2 yards. They stretched it all the way to the sideline.
The night and day differ for this ground game for Florida A&M. Non-existent for the first 30 minutes, but they have turned it around in this second half. Second and 8 from the 30, and they'll stay consistent with it. It's Hinderless over the right side. He is met by Deshaun Ray, setting up a third down.
And I like the fact that they ran the football because it opens up the playbook now with 35. You can either throw the football or run the football. I look for the quick pass from Florida A&M right now. You want to get the ball to your athletes in space and allow them to make plays for you.
Norwood has been the third down receiver today. He's lined up as a receiver, man-on-man coverage with Elliott Miller. See if they go his direction. They bunch 3 to the right. Kareem Smith in motion. Third down. They're looking for Norwood. Well covered. Stanley's going to pull in, and he went into the slide too premature that time. And they'll be shy of the first down. Into a protective slide when you need 4 or 5 yards. Last
bad.
Game of the year, you got to give up the body, don't
bad,
you?
Bad, bad, bad decision by Stanley. You've got to do what Larry Brim did on the previous drive. Put your head down and give one up for the team. You've got to run that. He had the first down, I think, if he puts his head down and continues to push forward.
Brown awaiting the punt from Badua. True freshman, Wesley Chapel, Florida. And it's a fake punt by Badua, and he is cut down at the 30.
Understand this play whatsoever. You're deep in your own territory. If you're in the 45, you know, 50-yard line, then yeah, maybe, but you've got the lead. Your defense has played pretty good. Outside of the first 10 points, your defense has done a good job. You see, I don't understand this play whatsoever. And you've got number 54 and number 55 give a no-hitter. Two guys on one and nobody hits the defender. You've got to hit the defender. You can't let him split you and get up the field and make the tackle.
It's the senior Cameron Rigby who somehow got by those two big blockers, and he makes the play of the game. Bethune-Cookman in business at the 32 and a timeout.
Bethune-Cookman, it's the first time out of the half. Will be a 30-second timeout.
If they get any piece of the body of Rigby there, Fadul probably picks up the first down.
I'm still trying to figure out right here. Two guys, what are you doing? It doesn't matter who's out there. You got to hit the MDM, most dangerous man. And it's Rigby. You got to hit him. 65 is looking at 54 like, what are you doing? No, 65, what are you doing? Both of you should be hitting him. Both of you should have roll graded him. Oh, my goodness. But once again, I don't understand the play call. If they converted, it's a great play call. but it's just not the play call to make. Now you put so much more pressure on your defense. You've given up a short field, and you've shifted momentum back on the Bethune-Cookman sideline.
We have visited the storylines of these two programs and their fortunes in the fourth quarter this year. Could we be heading down that similar path again? On the read, it's the RPO. Brim whistles it toward the sideline, hurdling the pile. Out of bounds, a good game. Double digits on the throw.
And you see Brim go to the same side as Elijah Price is, where all the pressure's coming from.
It's a pickup of 11 to Frank Brown, who's starting to heat up. Four catches today for Brown for 58 yards.
Timeout. Florida A&M. This is their first timeout of the half. Will be a 30-second timeout.
Turnovers and special teams will change a game quicker than anything.
And I put the onus on the coaching staff of Florida A&M for this because I think you punt the football. Your punter has punted extremely well, and you play field position football right now. You have the lead. There's no pressure on you. The pressure is on Bethune-Cookman University to score the football. No pressure on you as a team. But now, because you go for the fake punter, like I said, if those two guys make that block, it's the perfect play call. But they didn't, and that's what you have to factor in. If someone stays at home, and now they put their defense in a precarious position because they're backed up against their own goal line, and they know they've got to make a play. The third down and the fourth down were very bad for Florida A&M on that drive. First, Ryan Stanley deciding to slide as opposed to going to get the first down and then the fake punt.
Double move. Brim settles back for his initial target. It's Brown again making the catch, but this time he has nowhere to go. They use the sideline as the extra defender, Elijah Jones, another youngster, and Jacaris Wilson both in there to pick up of one, setting up a second and nine. Wilson, the team's top tackler, coming in, closing in on 100 tackles this year. A senior from right here in Orlando, Florida. What a moment this must be for him. A lot of friends and family enjoying this Florida Classic. Second down and nine. Brim on a hitter over the left side. Penalty flag is thrown as Jones moves the pile. Emilio Gibbs on top of him. Let's see what the penalty's all about.
Face mask. Once again, you got to keep your hands off the mask of the running back.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defense. Number 58. Pass the distance to the goal. Everybody first down.
It's the former linebacker turned tackle, Gibbs.
And this is the second time number 58, Emilio Gibbs, has gotten a face mask. Remember, early in the ball game, Emilio Epps had the safety, but he got the face mask on that play. And once again, he makes a big play, but he gives them an automatic first down with the face mask.
Untimely penalties coming back to bite FAMU. First and goal, Bethune-Cookman. From the 8-yard line, quick throw. They work the sideline, trying to get a couple of blocks as Brown, who's turned into a hurdler here on this drive as he goes leaping into the air. Gain of 4 yards, second and goal.
And good job blocking on the perimeter by Bethune-Cookman wide receivers, but a better job from the pursuit of the Florida A&M defense to get over there and get the ball carrier down.
See Brim trying to pick up the tempo, trying to get the attention of the center, Adams. They'll go up the center, following the lead block, diving ahead, touchdown, Michael Jones, 4-yard run. And here comes Bethune-Cookman.
And just like that, we've got ourselves a ball game. Penalties and missed assignments hurt Florida A&M on this drive. You see right here, you've got to wrap up. You've got to keep your head up. There's a defender right there, able to make the play, but he didn't keep his head up. You've got to keep your head up to make the tackle. You just can't go in there thinking you're going to hit a ball carrier and they're going to fall down.
Hernandez has only missed one point after this season to tie up the Florida Classic, and the kick is blocked. Oh, my. Somebody got a hand up, and Hernandez did not have enough airlift.
And I think it was number 31, Antonio Miller. You saw him rush right in the A-gap, and when he got through, he got that hand up.
How can you help but not smile at this one? The Florida Classic, we're heading our way toward a fantastic finish. The block point after, Rattlers survive. They lead by one. One rivalry to another. They've been playing this one since 1929. Tonight, 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. Number 11, USC hosts UCLA. Inside the Coliseum, Josh Rosen, Sam Darnold. You know the storylines. The victory bell on the line. The Trojans have owned the bell the last couple of meetings. They're looking to keep their firm grip on it. College football playoff hopes alive as well. Streaming live on the ESPN app. That's coming up tonight. 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC.
This is the battle for Florida. That's the battle for Los Angeles.
From one coast to another. This battle has a lot of storylines still to draw from. You talk about a complete reversal of momentum. It was all FAMU to start this fourth quarter, but a turnover. Special teams call that backfired, and now Bethune-Cookman breathing fire as they have fought back. The only difference, the block extra point just a few moments ago. Kareem Smith, a lot of horizontal running, dancing his way out to the 24-yard line as we go back to the block point after for the Rattlers.
And you see right here, the kicker doesn't get a whole lot of elevation on this kick. And right there, the defender, number 31, comes in and gets his hand in there, Antonio Miller. I'll tell you what, Miller and Price have been thorns in the side of Bethune-Cookman all afternoon. Remember, Miller had the big pickup on the fumble and run down the field where he was spinning and falling all over the place. But a great job by Miller splitting the offensive lineman and getting a hand up to get that block.
Let's see what type of composure Ryan Stanley has. On first down, he wanted to go deep. Nothing there. Stanley's going to tuck it and run. And he pays the price, falling ahead to the 28-yard line, hit by Joseph Johnson.
And you've got another player for Florida A&M down with cramps. Chad Hunter now is down, and his body's cramping up. And you're seeing that late in this ball game with a lot of these players. Stanley did a good job not trying to force it on that play. Got everything he could running the football. And I like on that play, unlike the previous play where he ran the ball on third down, he put his head down and made sure he got every possible yard that he could.
Stanley in the offense looking at second and six when we return to Orlando. Rattlers leading by one.
On the road from the
cramping has become a main issue for both these teams late in this game. Chad Hunter fighting a bout of cramps right now. He's on the bench getting attended to. Their home run ball, deep play threat. See if he can make a return. This passing game needs it. They have sputtered in the second half. Stanley just 5 of 10 for 55 yards after a solid first half. Second down and six. Up the middle, it's Hinderless, and not this time. It's Bethune-Cookman defensive front making the play. Todney Evans. What do you like here? Third down if you're FAMU.
Well, if I'm Florida A&M, if I continue to see Norwood getting man coverage on the outside without safety help over the top, I'm going to my big play receiver.
They bunch up the formation to the bottom of the screen. Third down, nice pocket integrity, and the tight end dropped it. Desmond Nord had to go right through the arms, and that would have went for first down yardage. Tight end's not a big part of this passing game, and Nord would love to have that one back.
But you got to make that catch, Nord. You cannot let that ball slip through your hands. That was a huge miss by Nord. even if Florida A&M is not able to score on this drive, if he makes that reception, they now have a new set of downs.
Bad duel to punt. Bethune sets up the return. Good spiraling kick and a Bearcat signal for it by Frank Brown. The third quarter belonged to the Rattlers. Tied at 10 and a half, it was the defense that turned up the heat. Elijah Price stripping the football, scooped up by Antonio Miller as he rumbled and stumbled his way, setting up the Rattlers in a perfect position. And from the Wildcat, Devin Bowers exploding up the center of the line. And FAMU was feeling pretty good. They held a 14-point edge. But ever since we moved to the fourth quarter, it's been all Bethune-Cookman. And it all started with the fake punt. The heads-up play holding his ground by Cameron Rigby, the senior. And then power football. Michael Jones plowing his way in. A point after block. And that's the difference in this game. A late handoff stretching out was Brim. And he was barely able to get the football off that time, as he scooted it to Jamaris Tompkins. Scary brief moment there for Bethune-Cookman.
And right now for Florida A&M, they've got to hold. They cannot allow Bethune-Cookman to even get into field goal position.
Showed a blitz off the corner. They pull back on first down, running to the boundary side. It's the big guy again. Tompkins having some success. He'll pick up close to 8 yards. Tyler Woodley, who has seen more action today with the targeting call to Orlando McKinley. 7-yard run. Second down. And Miller, the two ends. Smith, one of the down tackles. They bring Woodley on a corner blitz. That opens up Davis. He makes the catch and a first down. Great recognition by Larry Brim reading the corner blitz.
But Woodley gave it up too early, and Brim was able to go right where he came from. When you see the blitz, you want to go right where the blitz comes from immediately, because the safety has to react and get up on the ball. What you hope is your guy can get possession of the football and be able to make a football move on the safety, because he's the last line of defense.
On the FAMU side, huge hole over the left side. 6 more yards before he's brought down by Jabril Haisley. That time it's Michael Jones. And all of a sudden, the interior with Busareth, Adams, and Brown starting to open up some holes where there weren't any in the first three quarters. Little hitch pattern settling inside the zone and a first down to the 33. I don't think FAMU got their 12th guy off the field, did they?
They did not, and but they did. They brought in substitutions, mass substitutions on the defensive line.
Illegal substitution. Defense, 12 men on the field at the snap. That penalty's declined. Result of the play is the first down.
They brought in four defenders on the defensive line on that play, and the other guys weren't paying attention. You've got to pay attention, especially at this point in the ball game.
Frank Brown is starting to flex his muscle, the veteran receiver. 7 catches, 72 yards, 5 of those catches in this second half. And now you start to keep an eye on that clock a little bit. Bethune with 2 timeouts, more than 3 minutes to go. Already getting close to field goal range for Uriel Hernandez.
And I tell you what, I think for both teams, they understand this is the last drive. I don't think Florida A&M is going to get possession of the football again. I think for Bethune-Cookman, they know they've got to get either a field goal or a touchdown. And for Florida A&M's defense, they've got to get a stop. If they can get a sack, that really helps.
Brim looks like he's checking down on the play. Play clock down to 3. Here comes the blitz off the edge. Brim gets rid of it. Has a receiver wide open just beyond the reach. Incomplete. Brown was there, but Brim had to get rid of it a split second earlier than he wanted to.
And what was the free safety number 9, Andrew Hines, thinking on that play? You cannot worry about anything that's going on in the offensive backfield. You've got to be deeper than anything back there. Number nine, Andrew Hines, you've got to be deep. You cannot allow this to happen. If Brim just takes a little bit off the football, that is a touchdown. He was wide open.
Golden opportunity missed. Third down and eight. Here comes another blitz. Brim sidesteps it and throws a strike. In front of Hilton, making the catch is Jonathan Thomas, the true freshman, with the grab. And they're believing at Bethune. First down.
And you got to wonder, with Hilton paying so much, he came in the first quarter when McKinley got ejected. And you have to wonder, is attrition starting to set in for Hilton? Because he's been beat a couple of times on the outside. He's given too much ground, too much space to the receivers.
Approaching the two-minute mark of this fourth quarter, and now it will be the ground game. A strong surge by Bussereth and Bryant, and that catapults Tompkins 6 yards downfield, a gain of seven, second and three.
And if you're Coach Wood and Florida A&M, you have to start thinking about taking your timeouts, because you've got Bethune-Cookman in scoring position, and you want to make sure if they are able to get a score, you have some time on the clock to try to get the ball down the field and get yourselves in either field goal or touchdown position.
Tense moments on both sidelines. The young kicker, the veteran coach. Second down and three. Hawks skipping through a hole for first down yardage. See some jawing after the play, and if you're FAMU, you have to control those emotions. A four-yard gain, and here's the timeout we were anticipating. We'll be back with the finish from Orlando. A good one settling in. Bethune down a point on the march. Will Uriel Hernandez be called upon all by his lonesome on the sideline? First and goal, Bethune-Cookman. They're going to try to punch in six and not need Hernandez. Barreling ahead, no signal yet. And they're going to say out of bounds inside the one.
The runner is out at the half-yard line with a second down.
Jones thought he had number two, a burst of 8 yards.
And I thought Jones had number two as well. I want to look at that again because that looked like a touchdown. You see Jones out here, he's following his offensive lineman. He puts his head down right here. I don't see him out of bounds. I see the defender out of bounds. It looks like the ball may be across the goal line because he was on the balls of his foot, so his heel wasn't down.
Timeout.
Right here is a better look.
It's their second timeout. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
I think that's a touchdown because the ball is in his left hand. His left hand and the left side of his body is inside the pylon, but I don't know if it's clear enough for them to make that call because it's called down on the one on the field, but it looked like a touchdown to me.
Terry Sims taking that timeout, a very animated Terry Sims along the Bethune-Cookman sideline as he comes over to talk to the referee. So they are going to take a look upstairs at it to see if Jones had that football across the line before his left foot went out.
And you almost see the life taken out of the fan base for Florida A&M. They had a 14-point lead. Everything was looking up for them. They had the possession of the football. And it almost looked like they started to play not to lose and got conservative as opposed to playing to win. They haven't gone back offensively to Brandon Norwood with that crossing route, which was very successful early in the ball game.
Call stands, so back to action. Second down and goal. It's a stretch play, giving up a lot of ground in the backfield. Jones trying to turn the Jets, and he can't get there. Pursuit defense by the Rattlers. Quintez Gallen able to shadow him horizontally as he tried to sprint it to the pylon.
And this is when you have to have old school football in your playbook, and you go I formation, dot the I, get under center, hand it to your guys coming downhill.
Clock stops, getting out of bounds. Third down, naked bootleg, tap dance your way to six, Mr. Brim. Touchdown, Bethune.
And this is a case of undisciplined football by the Florida A&M defense. They played with aggression, and what Bethune-Cookman did is use FAMU's aggression against them. Watch the defensive end and the outside linebacker, and right here, everyone crashes down, and Brim gets the ball and comes all the way around, and nobody's there to touch him. Easy touchdown for Larry Brim. Nobody there. He actually walks into the end zone.
Bethune-Cookman, this is their third and final timeout of the half. It'll be a 30-second timeout.
The touchdown by Brim, and now Bethune-Cookman was lined up, ready for a two-point conversion, try to get that point after back and go up seven. So the Wildcats, for the second straight week, have pulled off a fourth quarter comeback. Now, we will put an asterisk by that, because with those two running plays going out of bounds that stopped the clock, FAMU still with a timeout. They were not forced to burn that third timeout to stop the clock. So now lots of time for a big play offense to try to pull off some late magic as well.
Well, you see the fan base of Florida A&M right now. They're shaking their heads. They're in disbelief because they thought they had broken that six-win streak. They thought they were going to not allow Bethune-Cookman to have number seven straight. And it's still not over, but it's not looking really good right now for Florida A&M because, you know, Bethune will play prevent defense. For Florida A&M's defense right now, you want to try and get a stop. Trying to stop this two-point conversion.
They sprint Brim right. He wanted the throwback left. He does. Loomis, the big tight end, has a lot of work to do, and he cannot slip free, so the two-point conversion fails.
And what's interesting about this now, because they didn't get the two-point conversion, all Florida A&M has to do is score a touchdown, and they win this ball game.
A 19-0 run in this fourth quarter by Bethune-Cookman, thanks in part to Larry Brim. 26 of 36 for 280 yards. He has the touchdown pass, plus Brim with the two rushing scores, and the fifth-year senior who has never lost in this Florida Classic. Remember, as a freshman, he was the guy who scored the game-winning two-point conversion in OT to give Bethune-Cookman a win, and now the senior in the biggest of moments able to come up down the stretch and lead this team to a five-point lead, and now it's up to his defense to preserve.
And I like what Brim is doing. He's walking the sideline. He's talking to his teammates. He's trying to get those guys motivated to go out and make a big play. That's what you want to see from your leader.
Kareem Smith on the return. Out past the 20, up to the 24-yard line. Don't forget tonight, tune in to SportsCenter at 1:30 Eastern, 10:30 Pacific on ESPN. Find out who Mel Kiper Jr. thinks is the best NFL prospect, Josh Rosen or Sam Darnold. Plus, don't forget about Wisconsin, the impact of Saturday's game on the college football playoff race, and NBA Saturday Night Hoops, a closer look at James Harden's historic hot streak. Sports Center tonight, Linda Cohn, Kevin Connors on ESPN and the ESPN app. Well, here we go. 40-plus thousand paid their ticket to watch this type of finish here. We have the Battle of the Bands and the Pride right now making some noise. First and 10, 76 yards away from where they need to be. Stanley hits his running back, Henryless, out of the backfield. He gets out of bounds, a pickup of 12 and a first down.
And they don't have to be in a rush because Henryless was able to get out of bounds, stop the clock. I'm surprised that Bethune-Cookman is playing man defense right now. They have to be very careful.
On first down, Stanley with time, throws in traffic, and it's caught. On the Bethune-Cookman side, preventing him from getting out of bounds.
But the clock will stop because it's a first down. And if you're Florida A&M, you have to run up to the line of scrimmage, be ready and set, so when the official sets the football and blows the whistle, you can go.
17-yard gain. Clock starts up again with the chains moving. 45 on the clock. Remember, FAMU has one timeout left. Now we have a penalty flag. Like procedure on the Rattlers.
And I didn't see the sense of urgency from Florida A&M that I needed to see on that play. They need to be down, ready to go when the clock starts back. You, Every second is precious right now. They're in a real good position. They're at the halfway point.
False start. Offense. Not all players were set before the snap. At the 5-yard penalty, will be first down. Florida A&M is elected to use their final timeout to avoid a 10-second red off. This is their third and final timeout of the half.
Smart move here. An unfortunate circumstance if you're Coach Wood, but the right move to prevent the runoff with the offensive foul.
Please reset the game clock to 46 seconds. 46 seconds.
So they'll add 3 more seconds onto the game clock, but now the Rattlers left without a timeout.
Well, they have to have a sense of urgency on the offense. They have to understand that you've got to be on the line of scrimmage set and ready to go when the official puts the ball down, because the clock will start and every second counts right here. And for Bethune-Cookman, this could be deja vu, but on the other side of the football. We talked about Bethune winning those close games this year in Florida A&M, losing those close games. Let's see if they can change that trend.
From the 49-yard line, the young sophomore certainly playing in the biggest spotlight of his career. Stanley's going to step up. He'll take a shot, throwing into double coverage, looking for Hunter, and it is intercepted by Richardson, his second pick of the day. Let the party begin at Daytona Beach. Bethune-Cookman has done it again.
Bethune-Cookman intercepted the ball. Momentum took him into the end zone. The ball be spotted at the 3-yard line. First down, Bethune-Cookman.
And that was a bad decision by Ryan Stanley. He threw it into double coverage. They had the receiver bracketed. They had a safety over the top. They had a defensive back, a cornerback underneath. And that is the throw that you cannot make. There were more defenders than offensive players. You see, Stanley's under pressure. He almost didn't get the ball off. He wasn't able to step into the throw. But you see them bracket the receiver. There was nowhere or no way the receiver, number 19, Kareem Smith, was going to be able to make a play on that football because they had coverage underneath and coverage over the top.
Who steps up in the biggest of moments? Your veterans and the senior Daquan Richardson, the preseason All-MEAC. Talked about how this year he was placed on the watch list for the Black College Football Player of the Year. One of 50 athletes on that list. One of 15 players from the MEAC. It's been a more mature Daquan Richardson this year, according to head coach Terry Sims. Last year, a number of personal fouls let his emotions get to him. Well, he can be emotional now. He has made play of the game defensively. And the story of the season for FAMU, a fourth quarter lead that they could not preserve. Well, just the opposite, a fourth quarter bunch of rallies this season by Bethune-Cookman will propel them to victory number 7 this year.
And there were some key plays, I think, that turned the tide for this ball game. When they allowed the defender to split both blockers and tackle the punter on the fake punt, that was a key play in this ball game. You go back to the beginning of the game, that safety that was taken off the board, that's 2 points. That changes this ball game.
Terry Sims and Alex Wood, mutual respect. We talked about heritage, legacy, pageantry. We had all three at this year's Florida Classic.
Absolutely a wonderful ball game by both sides. You hate to see someone lose a game like this, but hats off to this Bethune-Cookman ball club. They did not give up. They continued to fight.
Our final score from Orlando, Bethune-Cookman 29, Florida A&M 24. Coming up next, it's 30 for 30, Little Big Men. Forrest Conley, our entire crew here in Orlando. I'm Sean Kinney saying good evening from Camping World Stadium in Orlando, Florida. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports, Bethune-Cookman, for the 7th straight year, champions of the Florida Classic.